She's been chasing me ever since.
This old cat will never be tamed.
Just when you think you've got her licked, out of nowhere she takes a bite out of you.
And she's got one cause to keep you from crossing the finish line.
ESPN, the world's leader in motorsports coverage, presents Speed World. Today, the Trans-South 500 from Darlington International Raceway, being brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? By Budweiser, proud sponsor of the 1988 U.S. Olympic team. This Bud's for you. By Quaker State Motor Oil, the big Q stands for quality, always has, always will. And by Guardian Brake Products, safe stops start with Guardian. It is an absolutely beautiful afternoon here in South Carolina. Not a cloud in the sky, no chance of rain, a gentle breeze, and we're ready for the Trans-South 500. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Bob Jenkins, and this is the track they appropriately call Too Tough to Tame. With me is two-time Winston Cup champion Ned Jarrett, and it's indeed an event in which you challenge the racetrack as much as you challenge your fellow competitor.
In fact, I think you have to challenge the racetrack more than you do the fellow competitors, Bob, or you'll be sitting in the garage area watching the race. Every race fan has heard of the famous Darlington Strike. Well, that used to come when I was driving race cars back in the mid-60s in turns 3 and 4, when there was only a single guardrail there, and you literally ran the car right up next to that guardrail. If you were not touching it every lap, then you were not getting around the racetrack at maximum speed. Well, now the strike comes from turns 1 and 2. As the afternoon goes on, the cars will be running very high in that turn, some of them clipping the wall. Some of them will perhaps clip it a little too hard.
We've got some tire marks down there already. I'm sure they will be added to as the afternoon goes along. With me also is the research and development chief for Rick Hendrick Racing, Gary Nelson. And Gary, what does this track present a challenge for the crew chief?
Well, definitely one of the most challenging for the crew chiefs, but it's also very exciting. You know that the crew chief is the master mechanic in the garage area. He makes sure the car is prepared as well as possible. Then once the race starts, he's the coach. He gets the team pumped up for the pit stop. That's pretty difficult in some cases. Then later in the race, maybe if your car's in contention, the crew chief becomes a cheerleader, encouraging the driver to go on up to the front, try to win. So it's a constant changing role, but it's very exciting for the drivers and also the crew chiefs.
For the second time this year in Winston Cup competition, Ken Schrader is on the pole. He won the pole for Daytona, and that's where he'll start today's race. For that story, let's go to the pit area. One of our two pit reporters, Dick Bergren.
Well, Ken Schrader is starting on the pole, and is he hot here at Darlington? He's broken the track record by over 3 miles an hour. He's almost 2 miles an hour faster than the next quickest competitor. Kenny, can you keep up that kind of pressure all day and win?
Well, Dick, we're sure hoping to stay up right in the front all day, but I tell you what, there's about 12, 15 cars now that are all running about the same speed. You know, we had a real good qualifying lap, but I can hold my breath for 30 seconds almost any time, but I can't do it for 4 hours.
Well, Kenny Schrader would like to become a real star of Winston Cup racing, and one way to do it would be to win here. Maybe if he did, the local papers would get his name right.
Well, Dick Bergren, what a difference a year makes. Bill Elliott finished 87, winning 3 of the last 4 events. But if I would have told you that in 88, in the first 4 races, Elliott would not win and not have a top 5 finish, you'd say, well, this kid belongs in a room with rubber wallpaper. Well, that's the case. Elliott's had an abysmal start, including last week in Atlanta when he slammed the wall. In fact, his shoulder is hurting so bad, they have doctored the car here for Darlington. Take a look here. A rubber mount on the side of the seat will allow him to lay his shoulder and arm on top of this rubber piece to hang on to the steering wheel for all afternoon here at Darlington. And if you believe history, Larry Neuber, Elliott starting back in 15th spot cannot have a good possibility for a finish today.
Jerry, you are absolutely right. Only twice in the last 28 years here at Darlington has the winner started from beyond the top 10 starting position. Based on that, here is a list of people, in addition to Elliott, that should lose today. Terry Labonte, Harry Gann, and Darrell Waltrip. Conversely, starting in the top 10, that coveted positions, are 5 drivers that have never won a Winston Cup race. And modify all this with inside the top 20 starting positions, there are 18 drivers that are very unhappy with their careers up to this point. Only Dale Earnhardt and Bobby Allison are kind of satisfied. Everyone else desperate for a win.
All right, thank you, gentlemen. Let's take a look at the point standings going into this event. Neil Bonnett has a very slim points lead on Dale Earnhardt. It's only a margin of 4. Of course, at this point in the season, these drivers are going for the halfway mark, because at the halfway mark in the season, the bonus is $150,000 to the leader. 41 cars begin to move out to challenge the track too tough to tame. Back in just a moment. Today, live at Darlington International Raceway for the Trans-South 500, and here's a description of the racetrack. It is 1.366 miles in length. The banking is 22 to 24 degrees. The racetrack itself is 56 to 60 feet wide, but the racing groove is much narrower than that. Of course, the race length is 500 miles, and the fuel range the drivers will be getting between 90 and 100 miles. 367 laps will make up this event, and here now is the starting lineup. On the pole with a new track record of 162.657 in the Folgers Coffee Chevrolet, Ken Schrader, car 25. Outside of row number 1, the GM Goodrich Chevrolet, driven by Dale Earnhardt, car number 3. The second row, Alan Kowicki in the Xerox Ford, car number 7. And Jeff Bodine in the Levi Garrett Chevrolet, number 5. He won the Busch Grand National race here yesterday. Rusty Wallace starts inside of row number 3 in the Kodiak Pontiac, number 27. Then Brett Bodine in the Crisco Motorcraft Ford, car number 15. In the fourth row, it's Rick Wilson in the Kodak Film Oldsmobile, rather, car number 4, and then Lake Speed in the Wins Kmart Oldsmobile, car number 83. Starting in row number 5, the Haviland Star Ford, number 28, driven by Davey Allison. Alongside will be the Quaker State Buick, car 26, driven by Ricky Rudd. In row number 6 is Terry Labonte in the Budweiser Chevrolet, number 11, and the Skoal Bandit Chevrolet, number 33, driven by Harry Gant. Darrell Waltrip starts next in the Tide Chevrolet, car number 17. Outside of that seventh row will be Morgan Shepherd in the Shepherd Racing Buick, car 47. Going to row number 8, it's Bill Elliott in number 9 and Sterling Marlin in 47. And as you watch the rest of the starting lineup, I think one point we should emphasize right now, Ned, we mentioned that the track is 55 to 60 feet wide, but not nearly all of that is available for the racing crew.
When you go into those turns, Bob, it looked like it's more like 5 or 6 feet wide instead, but there are very few places on the racetrack that the cars can run side by side because the groove is so narrow. And if someone has trouble in front of you, it's almost impossible to miss them. That's why we see a lot of multiple car wrecks here at Darlington.
Gary, just before the start of the race, what's going through the crew chief's mind? What is he doing at this time?
Well, in most cases, the crew chief is talking to his crew members, the key members that go over the wall, talking about how we're going to set up this strategy, who's pitting in front of us, who's behind us, who to watch out for. Especially if you're right in the middle of a group of competitive cars, you know you're all going to pit at the same time. You have to get your crewmen aware of who's around them.
Our in-car cameras today are carried by Alan Kowicki, the Xerox Ford. He's moving the car down into turn number 1 on one of 4 warm-up laps. Alan Kowicki making sure the tires are heated up for the start of this race, and our other in-car camera will be carried by Dale Jarrett in the Hardy's Oldsmobile. And Dale is a new father. His wife gave birth to a new baby girl about 36 hours ago, and there's the happy father. And up here in the booth, of course, is the happy grandfather.
Okay, it was quite a thrill yesterday when his wife gave birth to Natalie. And, of course, Dale went on to round third in the race yesterday, too.
Very good performance. In fact, he led the late stages of that Busch Grand National race yesterday, which was won by Jeff Bodine. So the field now behind the pace car up in turns number 3 and 4 as 41 cars get set to go for 367 laps. The grandstand is full and we are about ready to go.
Bob, this is one of the most critical laps of the race, the very first one, because they're bunched up side by side. If someone gets a little over anxious, it can really be tough on them. So everybody has to really be concentrating heavy right now as the green flag is about to drop.
Out of turn number 4, Ken Schrader leads him down. There's the green flag and the Trans South 500 is underway. Everybody through turns 1 and 2 nicely as down the backstretch it is Kent Schrader leading, and there's the battle for second position as Jeff Bodine has moved to the inside and passed Dale Earnhardt for that second position. Schrader leads. And the roar from the engine shakes this grandstand as they go through the first turn onto the backstretch once again. Dale Earnhardt, who started second, has dropped back to third position, allowing Jeff Bodine to capture that second position. Behind Dale Earnhardt is the Xerox Ford, driven by Alan Kulwicki, as Ken Schrader continues to set the pace. He's moved out several car lengths ahead of Jeff Bodine.
A little surprising that Jeff Bodine was able to move around Dale Earnhardt as early as he did. In practice here yesterday afternoon, Earnhardt's car looked very stable. It looks very stable today as well, but Bodine making a quick run there at the beginning.
Darrell Waltrip, Morgan Shepherd, and Bill Elliott attempt to move up through the field. They are currently 13th, 14th, and 15th.
Well, they've already sprung out. You know, they went single file in the first lap. That's one of the most unusual things about this track over all the others. They run two abreast for several laps than most all the other racetracks.
Gary, I remember back in 1964, I talked about that very first lap. I started close to Darrell Derringer, who's watching today and recuperating at home. He spun going into turn one right in front of me. I had to spin to dodge it. He got the car straightened out, went down into turn three. He spun it again. There I was, right behind him again, and both of us spun twice on the first lap. But fortunately, we didn't hit anything.
And there were 366 more laps to go in that race. As you can see, Darrell Waltrip, Morgan Shepherd, and Bill Elliott trying to move up through the field. That's Harry Gant right ahead of the Tide Chevrolet, driven by Darrell Waltrip.
Kyle Petty is in trouble in turn one. It looks like the engine has let go on the Citgo Ford number 21.
And we have a spin, several cars spinning because of the block visibility. There's a tremendous amount of smoke coming from that Petty car, and cars pile up behind him. There you see Bobby Hill Jr. in number 8. Ernie Irvin, the number 2 car, has spun to the infield. I believe that Benny Parsons was also involved. I saw his car sideways. I do not see where the car is right now, however, that Ernie Irvin's car has been damaged severely, and there's still bad visibility at the end of the front stretch going into turn number 1.
There were two things that happened there. The smoke was so bad that they couldn't see where they were going, and then a few of them, of course, would get into the oil. Gary?
Yeah, Richard Petty, very badly damaged. Neil Bonnet also. Tough break. You know, that's one of the worst kind of engine explosions to have. It was a piston or something, puts all the oil in the exhaust and just sets up a smoke screen. None of the drivers could see where they were going. They were necessarily, there may not have been anything on the racetrack for them to hit, but they couldn't tell.
Well, all the cars, with the exception of Richard Petty's, begin to move away from the scene of the accident. Ernie Irvin has gotten that car restarted, and he's headed for the pits on the backstretch. But there is the Richard Petty car, and you can see he took quite a hit, and another terrible break for Richard Petty, who, of course, was involved in that tremendous accident at Daytona in February.
And then, of course, was an early victim at Rockingham a few weeks ago when another car hit him going into the turn, and he was out of the race in the first 10 laps.
So we have at least 6 cars that were involved in that incident down there in turn number 1, and there is the Michael Waltrip car, number 30, which has damage to the right front of the car and a cut tire. So the first caution flag of the afternoon comes out over Darlington International Raceway in the Trans South 500. We'll be right back.
Western North Carolina, where majestic mountains reach up to touch the skies, where each season brings a new beginning, a place we can all be proud to call home. where people work hard and values run deep. The quality of life has never been better in Western North Carolina, and the promise the future holds grows brighter every day. At Total Reach Television, we salute the businesses and industries of Western North Carolina, providing the jobs and opportunities we need for a strong future in our area. And we encourage you to support the local businesses of your choice. You'll be helping to keep our economy and our commitment strong in Western North Carolina.
Caution flag is out on lap number 7 here at Darlington. Kyle Petty blew an engine going into turn number 1 and put up a tremendous amount of smoke, and the cars and drivers behind him just simply could not see where they were going, and 6 cars spun and crashed.
And you can see the smoke as he went into the turn. Kyle was able to get the car on the low side of the racetrack. Dale Jarrett in the Hardy's Oldsmobile was right behind that, so let's watch him and see what he saw as he went in. He was motioning the driver behind him to slow down. And you can see that he could not see anything as he went into that turn.
You just got to point it and hope you don't hit anything.
Well, Dale apparently scraped the wall a little bit, but he was able to continue on around. We could see a little bit of damage on the right side of the car as he came around after making a pit stop. And boy, that is a blind situation to go into.
Here are the 6 cars that were involved in the accident. Ernie Irvin, Neil Bonnet, Richard Petty, Benny Parsons, Bobby Hillen Jr., and Michael Waltrip. And there apparently is the most seriously damaged car. That, of course, is Richard Petty.
You know, it was interesting to see that all that take place. It was a chain reaction accident, but Kyle Petty just drove right on around and into the garage area with no damage, no spin or anything. So it was definitely the visibility that caused the action. The accident with that many cars running that close to each other.
Let's go to Jerry Punch.
Kyle Petty still sitting in the Citgo Ford. Kyle, what happened up there?
I don't know. I guess we blew up. It's hard to tell. You know, we were running pretty good. This is the best Citgo Ford's ever run good. Best I've ever run here. So, you know, we run the first 5 or 6 laps, and I guess knocked the bearings out of it. I don't know. We just have to check it and see.
When that happens early in the race and so many cars so close together, there's nothing the guys behind you can do.
Well, there's really nothing they can do. I mean, I don't think we... Maybe we put down oil. I don't know. You know, it's hard to say. I really didn't get out of gas when it started. It just started smoking. It didn't really blow up. And so I went ahead and run it through the corner down there and come back around and everybody's in the wall. I hate it, but I mean, you know, that happens sometimes.
Well, that's Kyle Petty. He's in the garage area. And Neil Bonnet's on pit road getting some work done on his heavily damaged car.
Yeah, the damage there on the Bonnet machine is to the rear end of the car. And it doesn't appear to be too serious, although, as you say, they are pounding out the sheet metal and changing tires on the car. Unfortunately, the man who suffered the most damage in this accident is Kyle Petty's father, Richard, who was very badly damaged in the front end of that race car. So while we're under caution, we're going to take this break and be right back for more of the Trans South 500. The oil that was put down on the racetrack in turn number 1 and the sheet metal that came off of cars as they crashed together down in turn number 1. There you can see the work going on in the Neil Bonnet cars. That car has sustained damage in the rear end and on the left side. Now here's a replay from inside Dale Jarrett's car.
And this is at full speed as he goes down the front straightaway. He sees Kyle Petty or someone in trouble. He throws his hand up to the drivers behind him, and then he just has to go blind because he can't see what is in front of him.
Boy, that's bad. And that heavy of a traffic, it's almost impossible for a driver to know what he's doing. Just try and almost close your eyes and drive through and hope you make it.
Tough on a new dad and a granddad, too.
Well, there is Dale, who has kind of taking some deep breaths and saying, well, I survived that one, and I hope I can do it again. We'll try to talk to Ned Jarrett. Ned, this is Bob Jenkins up at ESPN. Can you read me? Well, we can see Dale trying to communicate, but we're not getting a signal from him. So, Dale, this is Bob Jenkins. Do you read me? Now, we're having a problem. We'll try to get the problem corrected and do it a little bit later. But Dale is, like I say, relaxing after surviving that near tragedy in the very early stages of the Trans-South 500.
Bob, every driver that starts anywhere really from about 10th on back in this race are concerned about the first 100 miles or so. Say, hey, if we can stay out of trouble for 100 miles, get ourselves sorted out here, then we have a good chance of having a good run here today. Because when something happens to one car in front of you, you know, as I said at the top of the show, it's normally a multiple car accident.
As you can see, the yellow is still out, but in one more lap, we'll be going back to green now. Neil Bonnett and Michael Waltrip have lost a lap in that incident. However, Bobby Hillen Jr. managed to stay on the lead lap. And, of course, Richard Petty's car was very heavily damaged, so he at the moment is not out there on the racetrack.
We mentioned that Benny Parsons was also involved in that. Not too much damage to Benny's car. He's made several pit stops, but apparently not too much damage to his car.
Let's go to Pit Central and Larry Neuber.
Two comments, guys. First of all, Richard Petty from the cockpit. Well, fellas, I'm in another one. Brad Knopfinger, a conversation before the race started. He qualified very disappointingly. He felt that he was one of the fastest 20 cars in this race, but he said that in the early laps of this race, I'm going to hold back. And we mutually agreed that once he waited for as long as he thought was appropriate, he ought to wait twice as long because he didn't know what was going to happen. Dick Berger in the pits.
And there's an awful lot of work going on in Neil Bonnett's car. They're working on both the front and the back end. This is his fifth pit stop since the accident. They're trying to get the sheet metal out of the tires and off the racetrack, and there's absolutely sheet metal bent everywhere on this car. This, by the way, is the same automobile ESPN viewers saw Neil Bonnett win Rockingham in.
And the green flag comes out. We are back to racing on lap number 12. As the field moves into single file formation to go into corner number one once again. Ken Schrader still the leader. Jeff Bodine is running in second position. Then it is Dale Earnhardt running in third.
It may have been a good break for Davey Allison, may not have been. He stopped on that yellow flag. He wasn't involved in the wreck. He was ahead of it. But then maybe he had a flat tire, so he got his four tires changed. But now he has to restart in the back, has to work his way up through that traffic. It's going to be an interesting few laps for Davey.
Rusty Wallace has moved to third, passing Dale Earnhardt.
Yesterday here in practice, Rusty Wallace had one of the fastest cars in practice, Bob. He was really getting around this racetrack. He could keep it right down on the bottom in turns one and two when he needed to. He is expecting to have a good day here.
Schrader takes the car up toward the outside wall in corners number three and four. Jeff Bodine is right behind him as they come down the straightaway.
Jeff Bodine looks awful strong in his turns also. He's passed Dale Earnhardt, which is something that Earnhardt didn't let him do. You know, the way Earnhardt drives, he wants to lead every lap. So for Jeff and also Rusty Wallace to go around Earnhardt, that shows that they're running pretty good.
Jeff Bodine making a bid for the lead down the backstretch, side by side with Schrader as they go into turn number three. The inside line is where you want to be. Jeff Bodine grabs the first spot momentarily, but the car drifts high, and Ken Schrader comes side by side with Jeff coming out of corner number four. And oh, Schrader is sideways, almost loses it, saves it miraculously, but Jeff Bodine has the lead.
Boy, they're not really racing like teammates there, are they?
And they're also not racing like this is a 500-mile race.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
Yeah. Long ways to go.
Well, Schrader is dropping back to fourth position now as Dale Earnhardt passes on the outside, goes to third.
Whoop, and Schrader
now Schrader is spinning this time and hitting the wall. Up in turn, and several cars are going to be involved. Many cars are going to be involved in this. Well, again, a lot of traffic behind Ken Schrader, and there was just no place to go for several of the cars, including Terry Labonte. Darrell Waltrip was involved. Harry Gann has been damaged. And a second caution flag stops the racing here at Darlington.
Schrader tried to get back in behind the car that had just passed, which that was
Alan Kowicki.
And he clipped Kowicki as he went back in, which threw him out of control.
Yeah, what a shame. That was really one of the most dangerous spots on the track, and I'm sure Kenny thought he had the room, but just missed it by a couple inches and caused that big wreck.
17 laps completed, and once again a caution. There's Ken Schrader's damaged machine in both the front end and the back end, and the pole sitter of this race has suffered a misfortune in the very early going. There is Rick Wilson's car involved. Here is a replay of the action in turn number three.
Okay, he was up beside of Earnhardt just a little bit. He tried to slip back in behind him, but Alan Kowicki was trying to get in that hole himself. He clipped Alan just enough to throw himself out of control. Kowicki gets down on the inside, but here comes the field behind him. And as we say, very few single car accidents here at Darlington.
Boy, what a wreck. Bam, there's Waltrip, Labonte, a lot of top cars taken out of that contention in that one.
Including Piedmont Airlines Oldsmobile of Sterling Marlin, who had very high hopes here today.
And then you can see Brett Bodine being pinned by Rick Wilson, who takes this car very high on the track, and then others piling into this mess.
Boy, what a rough break for Brett Bodine. He's been in, I think, in every race this year, he's been in an accident, not his fault.
Now we have an in-car camera view, and this is Alan Kulwicki's version of it.
You can see his car get hit just enough to move Kulwicki's car a little bit, but more than that, it threw Schrader out of control. Now, that was not Alan Kulwicki's fault, because he was running in the groove. Schrader was trying to get back in there. He thought he had room to get between Earnhardt and Kulwicki, but Kulwicki had already closed the gap, and there was simply not room there for the car.
Yeah, it was almost like Schrader was trapped out of the groove, and he was backing up through the traffic, and he wanted to force an opening there.
Kenny apparently is okay, but will be taken into the ambulance and perhaps checked over at the infield care center. So a second accident here in the early going of the Trans-South 500, back right after this. Back at Darlington International Raceway in South Carolina, live coverage of the Trans-South 500, 19 laps completed, and already we have had two multi-car accidents. Alan Kulwicki and Ken Schrader got together up in turn number three and sent Schrader spinning it into the wall, and there were five other cars that became involved in the incident. There you can see Alan Kulwicki from our in-car camera. He's discussing the accident with members of his crew, and as soon as that conversation is finished, we'll be talking with him from up here in the booth.
They were talking about the tire stagger, of how they want to change it a little bit. And you can see that they hear that the crew has zeroed in on what he wants. Alan Kulwicki, this is Ned Jarrett. Do you read me?
Ned, I read you loud and clear. Go ahead.
Boy, that was a close one for you over there. It looked like that Kenny was trying to find a hole and there just wasn't room.
Yeah, he looked really loose coming off before, a couple laps before that. And I thought it was a little bit early in this race to be running like that. I hate to see Kenny go out, but, you know, I was sort of on the outside of him there, and I think he just squeezed me up and quit me going into the third turn.
Was there any damage to your car that you can feel?
I think the Xerox Ampro 4 Thunderbird is just fine.
Okay, well, good luck.
Thank you.
So that's a story from Alan Kulwicki, and here is a replay of the accident. Inside Alan Kulwicki's car. And that's what it sounds like when there's an accident.
Boy, good camera work, guys. That was a heck of a shot.
So there is Kulwicki, who will line up in fourth position for the restart. Jeff Bodine still has the lead. Rusty Wallace is second, then Dale Earnhardt, and then Alan Kulwicki. Darrell Waltrip has come in to get the sheet metal pulled away from the tires on that car. He was involved in the Schrader-Kulwicki incident. He's trying to keep from losing a lap. Field is coming out of turn number four. And Terry Labonte's car is behind the wall, as you can see on the right side of your screen. And there is Terry Labonte waiting impatiently, really, inside the car. And Dick Bergman is right there.
Well, Terry Labonte, usually this is one of your better racetracks. Not today.
Not one today. You know, I had a little wreck up there, and I missed the guys in front of me, but I couldn't miss the ones behind me.
What all happened around you? How wild was it?
I don't really know what happened. I saw a Schrader spinning, and a couple of guys got into him. We were all trying to slow down to miss it. Somebody ran in the back of me and drove me right into it.
Well, you've got mechanics working on three out of the four corners of this car. Is this thing repairable? Can you get back?
Well, you know, if there's any way to get it fixed, I guarantee the Junior Johnson crew is going to get it done. We've got to get out there, you know, and try to finish if we can, just to get as many points as we can.
Points this early in the season, they're very concerned about it, and these guys are working up a storm. The car is on jack stands, there's no tires and wheels on it, and half the crew is under the automobile. Larry Neuber, what's going on in pit central?
Well, Dick, I'm standing by with Kenny Schrader, one of the principals, if not the principal, involved in that. Kenny, your view of where you were seated.
Well, we dropped out of line there and got loose trying to get back under Jeff the lap before, and Rusty got by and Dale got by, and I was just trying to get back up in line, you know, and we all run pretty close, and I guess Alan had a couple inches of front end up in there, and it just turned us right, and, you know, knew we weren't going to get her gathered back up then.
Kenny, how much driver error, how much racetrack involved in that? We're going to look at the replay of this so that you can call it as you see it again from your vantage point. There we are, coming down the front straightaway. You can see yourself moving in. Where were you at that point as far as your mind?
I was trying to get tucked up back behind Dale, you know, so a bunch of them wouldn't go by, and then just, you know, I cut it too close and, you know, go up the left front Allen.
Now we have a second angle. On a lot of racetracks, there seems to be room for error, but not here.
Yeah, there's just not enough room here. Once you get turning a little bit, it turned to the right. We got her back to the left, but there was no way to stop that slide. We just kept going up.
Well, one other thing about Kenny, and probably you're not even aware of this, Kenny, but Bob Kelly from the R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company conducted an informal poll with everybody here in the pit area yesterday at Darlington, and it was, who among all the non-winners would be the first to win? And you won by a 2-1 margin, but it's not going to happen today.
No, we have to go to Bristol because we definitely aren't going to get her today.
Okay, keeping up with the action on pit road, our Jerry Punch.
Harry Gant continues to make stops on pit road, and what a tough day for Gant. The car back in on the jack. The entire front control van, the Chevrolet, has been sheared away. The front end of the car is completely gone, and Gant now makes his way back down pit road.
Another car on pit road receiving service and trying to keep from going a lap down is Brett Bodine, who was involved in the incident up there in turn number 3. And there you can see the Junior Johnson crew working on the Terry Labonte machine, trying to make it up here. There is Bodine now going behind the wall, so they're going to have to do some more extensive repairs to that car before it can resume the race, if it can at all. So we're still under caution for the cleanup with 23 laps completed, the top 10, and we'll be back after one more lap. We'll be going back to green. And gentlemen, it's been an interesting race to this point with only a very few laps run under green. Now the GM Goodrich team of Dale Earnhardt, they've been oblivious to all this action out on the racetrack because their driver Dale Earnhardt has survived everything, and Cecil Gordon and the others are taking a lunch break, it would appear.
Looks like very relaxed they are out at the moment. Of course, one advantage to starting up front is missing a lot of those early accidents here. However, that one did happen up towards the front.
Boy, it happened right behind Dale. Yeah, it took out quite a few cars. Most of the top 20 cars have had some kind of contact already, and we're only 25 laps into the race.
But one of those who has survived all of the spins is Bill Elliott, who started in 15th position, but he's survived unscathed so far. Harry Gant has just gone behind the wall
into the garage area, so that apparently the damage was too extensive to repair on pit road. We're about ready to go to green, Bob.
We mentioned that Brett Bodine went behind the wall, but that was only momentarily. He's now back out there in competition, but several laps down as the green comes out on lap number 26. Back to racing. That's Dale Earnhardt moving to the inside of Rusty Wallace into turn number 1, trying to capture second, but he cannot. Single file formation through turns 1 and 2. Only 17 of the 26 laps that we have run so far in this Trans South 500 have been under green racing conditions.
Jeff Bodine and Rusty Wallace look like they're awful strong.
Both of those drivers put in a lot of laps in practice here yesterday afternoon after the Good Friend National race, trying to get them dialed in just right. However, we had a lot of rain here last night, Gary, which washed the rubber off of the track, but it don't seem to affect the handling of those cars very much.
No, it seems like, either you hit it right off the bat and you're lucky, but it's still a lot of guesswork after it rains overnight just before a race starts.
Jeff Bodine and Rusty Wallace are setting the pace as Dale Earnhardt trails about a car length behind. Then comes Alan Kulwicki running in fifth position. Is Lake Speed another one of those non-Winston Cup winners who has qualified very well for this event, and now Earnhardt begins to sneak up on Rusty Wallace and close that gap between second and third. Earnhardt, who won his first Winston Cup points paying event of 1988 last weekend at Atlanta. Of course, he won the Busch Clash at Daytona earlier this year, but that's not a points paying event for Winston Cup.
You know, when you talk about points, Bob, it is one of the biggest things of the season. These are little battles, these races, but you think about the points year long. So if you are involved in a minor accident early in a race like this and you're looking for the points, then you do fix your car and try and get in it. A lot of times after repairing a car like that, it's not ideal to get back into the race. You know, Darrell Waltrip had heavy damage. He spent a lot of time in the pits repairing his car. He's back out there running now. You can see the damage to the left rear, the back, the right side. You know, there's little panels in there behind the fenders that that seal to the fenders to keep the dust and the wind and everything from blowing into the driver's compartment. I can imagine after a wreck like that, that Darrell's being peppered with the sand off the racetrack. The car definitely isn't as aerodynamic, and he's looking at a long day before the end of this one if he's going to try and tough it out.
Darrell did stay on the lead lap, so he is battling for position out there. Bobby Allison is right ahead of him. Now he moves to the inside of Allison as they go into turn number three. That's Rodney Combs right ahead of Waltrip, and we got another spin, and it's right ahead of the group of cars that we were talking about, and that's a slender new Oldsmobile driven by Brad T. I don't think this is going to cause any problems behind him, however, and it may not bring out a caution as Brad T has the car headed in the right direction and still moving. So we do not have a yellow, and the race continues.
Fortunately, he was able to spin down out of the racing group, Bob, out of the way of the other traffic.
And he was running in 17th position, Brad Teague was, when the spin occurred. Now we do have a yellow. Caution flag comes out, and we are again reduced speed.
Probably some debris that came off of his car as he spun around.
Boy, you know, if they weren't watching it on ESPN, his crew might not have even known that he spun out as quick as he recovered.
Here once again is a replay. Looks like there may have been some contact there.
Could have been as he went into that number three turn. The back end goes around, everybody else going high, hoping that he will not come back up into the groove. And amazingly, the car does stay down. Usually it'll shoot right back up across the racetrack right into the groove. Darrell Waltrip, Rodney Combs in the car number 97. They're able to get by. Rodney, of course, celebrating a birthday today in the AC spark plug Buick number 97.
Can you imagine what Darrell Waltrip's thinking? Well, here comes the pit stops. The leaders in, all the leaders are coming in. All just about everybody finally making their first pit stop, 33 laps into the race.
All right, now what have you learned as a crew chief in the first 33 laps that you might be able to change on the cars?
Well, you talk to the driver about loose, pushing, maybe it might be running a little warmer. You can adjust some of the air into the radiator. A lot of things you can do. Here you can see just about everybody's getting four tires. It's a race out of the pits. A lot of guys are dropping the jacks. Here comes Rusty Wallace first. Looks like he's going to beat Bodine. Bodine had a tire in his way, just cuts in front of Rusty Wallace and beats him to the end of pit road.
But Bill Elliott beat all of them out.
Yeah. And Rusty Wallace was involved in an incident on pit road yesterday during the Busch Grand National race. He made contact with Dale Earnhardt as Earnhardt was pulling out, and Rusty got on the binders there to keep from hitting the Bodine car.
Here's Dale Jarrett on the backstretch in for a pit stop as they add some fuel. We saw him clean the windshield a moment ago. Dale had moved up in about 14th position, I think. Was going up pretty good through the field.
That's a good shot of the gas cans. What that is on the end, it's off of the in-flight refueling systems off an aircraft. That is a probe that won't leak until they put it into the quarter panel of the car. Then it opens up and pours the gas in.
So it seals and prevents any leakage from coming up.
Right.
All right, yellow once again, 34 laps completed. We hope you're going to stay with us for a long afternoon, an exciting afternoon of racing. We have just gone green on lap number 35 here at Darlington. The race resumes, and the leader of the event is Davey Allison. In second position, I believe, is Mark Martin. And in third is Ken Bouchard, fourth, Benny Parsons. Now, Davey Allison has had bad luck at this racetrack, especially last year when he spun on a couple of occasions. We saw that in the very open of our program, but Allison has the lead at the moment. Now, let's go to Larry Neuber in Pit Central.
Bob, recall that part of that super team of Rick Hendrick is Ken Schrader and Darrell Waltrip. They are, in effect, teammates. Gary was mentioning about the damage to the Darrell Waltrip car. Maybe signaling will be a long day for Darrell Waltrip. There you see Darrell on your screen. Well, there's been a conversation on the radio between Jeff Hammond, crew chief, and Darrell saying, hey, have Schrader stand by in the pits because it's very warm in here. I'm not absolutely certain that I can go the distance. Remember, there's a lot of heat in the rear of the car that the race car itself generates. Harry Hine, the crew chief for Ken Schrader, said, I don't know, let me think about that. My driver, Kenny's had a long weekend. Both Saturday and Sunday were pretty torturous days.
Well, that's quite interesting that Darrell is running as strong as he is. You know, they had to readjust the alignment. The front toe end was out. I could see the crew adjusting it on the pit stops. They must have made 10 stops to repair that car. Now he looks like he's running pretty competitively. He's not losing any ground, that's for sure.
You know, that car right ahead of Darrell is Rodney Combs in the number 97 machine that Morgan Shepherd started the season with, and he's run a very competitive race so far. He's been staying right up there with the first half of the field.
I'm impressed with Rodney Combs. He's been around for a while, you know, on the dirt tracks for a long time, one of the top winners on the dirt circuit, and now he's getting a chance in a good stock car.
And a chance that's well-deserved as well, Gary. He's had a lot of success in dirt track racing. He told me this morning he won over 350 events and has wanted to get into Winston Cup racing. Now the Tom Winkle people have finally given him that opportunity. He wants to make the best of it.
Here you can see Jeff Bodine just coming into the screen. It's very frustrating for him being the leader, making a pit stop, and all these other cars could not stop. That meant when the race restarted, he's way back and he has to pass them. He has to really be careful at this point. He knows he's faster than these guys, but like we've seen twice already, you can't go too wide in turn three.
Bill Elliott right ahead of Jeff Bodine. I would imagine that those cars that are up front right now are saying that's where we want to be because of all the accidents that we've had with cars piling up in front of us. They want to stay up front to have clear sailing.
Well, you're right. You know, the yellow came out on lap 33. Some of these cars that are up in the front part of the pack, they haven't even stopped at all yet. A couple of them, I'm sure, have been out there on their fuel. They're looking at the race and saying there's been a lot of cautions. There'll be more. Even though we're halfway through our fuel tank, let's go ahead and stay out there. Hopefully we'll avoid some of the problems that have been happening.
Bill Elliott there on the right side of your screen. And we have a report from Jerry Punch, who's with Dan Elliott.
Interesting piece of strategy here. You know, they came in and only changed two tires. Dan, why?
More positions, get further to the front. It seems like we're having an awful lot of wrecks early in the race, so we want to get as far to the front as we could, so we thought we could just put two tires and gain some positions and stay out of some trouble.
Well, Gary Nelson, you hit it right on the head. The danger zone they talk about here at Darlington, about 15 spot on back, and Elliott wanted to get up front, so only took two tires instead of four.
Well, that kind of strategy certainly will help to put you up front. Gary was talking a moment ago about those cars up front that had not stopped. Davey Allison, who is leading, did make a stop on the first caution, so at least he has one pit stop under his belt.
Right, he has a little more fuel than some of the cars, but it's very interesting to watch Jeff Bodine work his way through the traffic. Bill Elliott now a couple cars behind Bodine. Jeff has passed several cars. He's getting maybe one every couple laps, and that's pretty aggressive racing this early in the race. Jeff definitely wants to lead this race.
Darrell Waltrip, Phil Parsons, and Jeff Bodine behind Rodney Combs, who is in fifth position. Sixth is Waltrip. Now Waltrip moving inside on the straightaway, trying to pass Rodney Combs, but unable to do so.
Here you see Jeff went by Phil Parsons going into the corner. Now coming off the corner, he's going by Darrell Waltrip. He definitely wants to lead.
The car's getting good traction off the turns, and that's a good sign, Gary.
Oh, definitely. This early in the race, to be that much stronger, to move up like that.
Well, there is Waltrip, who's sliding high on the racetrack, and everybody's going around him.
He's crippled. He knows he's got a long day. He's not going to fight with anybody for a position here and there. He knows that by the end of the day, he's just going to be able to do his best to finish in the top 10 if he's lucky.
So Davey Allison is the leader of the race. Mark Martin is second. Benny Parsons is third. Fourth is Greg Sachs. And fifth is Rodney Combs.
We mentioned that Harry Gant had gone into the garage area earlier, Bob. He has now come back out onto the racetrack, but he's several laps down, a lot of damage done to his car, as we saw Dale Earnhardt move around Darrell Walker.
But among those who are still in the pit area, trying to get the damage all worked out from those accidents, there's Bodine going to the inside of Rodney Combs into turn number one and taking the position. Rick Wilson is still behind the wall, and so is Terry Labonte. So Jeff Bodine moves into fifth now, putting Rodney Combs back to sixth. Then we have Phil Parsons in seventh. And here comes Davey Allison, who is leading the Trans-South 500, coming down to complete lap number 46. And we talked earlier about how you have to concentrate every moment when you're out there for 367 laps. Davey talked with us about that.
Last year we were running really good here and thought we had everything covered, just sitting there taking it easy and let my concentration drift off a little bit and slid into the wall over here coming off of four and ended up cutting the tire down, and then a couple laps later I crashed. And then the spring race last year, we just cut a tire down, you know, everything was going smooth and had come right up through the field, back up to about third or fourth place, and thought things were going great then, and here I cut a tire down and crashed in and had the big fire. So, you know, it's just one of those racetracks that you just can't take anything for granted. You got to concentrate 100% of the time and never let your concentration drift away.
At the moment, Davey Allison is concentrating and concentrating well because he's in the lead, about an 8-second advantage for Davey Allison.
He is concentrating very well. That car is handling very well, too. He thought that if he had an opportunity to get out front early in this race, that he could maintain the lead, and he has pulled away from the second-place car. However, now that Jeff Bodine is moving up through the field, he might be the fastest car on the track, but he still has a little traffic to take care of.
Yeah, that's right. Davey Allison does have a good jump because Jeff was working through that traffic. There are some cars between Davey and Jeff, but the two quickest cars at the moment on the racetrack are definitely Davey Allison and Jeff Bodine.
The average speed of the race is 94.8 miles an hour, but that takes into consideration all of the yellows we've had. The green light average speed is 158.9. We'll be right back. At the moment, Davey Allison in a Ford leads the Trans-South 500. The last Ford win at this racetrack was in the Trans-South 500 was Bill Elliott's victory in 1985. Allison leads Mark Martin. In third place belongs to Greg Sachs, Benny Parsons back to fourth, and then Jeff Bodine in fifth.
And those five cars are fairly well scattered out, Bob. But then back behind them is a real battle with Rodney Combs running in the sixth position, I believe. No, Dale Earnhardt has now moved up to sixth, but Rodney Combs and then a lot, about eight or ten cars behind him, really having a battle.
Boy, it is quite a race already. Only 53 laps into it. We got over 300 and a little over 300 laps to go. It's going to be quite a show by the time this is over.
Amazingly, there are still 24 cars in the lead lap, even after those two big accidents we had.
Yeah, you know, after a wreck like that, those guys that go to the garage, they work on a car, sometimes they don't look too much like race cars when they come back out, but they're out there chasing those points.
Davey Allison continually, you saw there Brett Bodine, who was involved in an earlier accident. He's back out there on the racetrack. Let's go to Dick Bergeron.
Now that I'll guarantee he was not going to win the best appearing award, here is his crew chief, Jeff Hammond. Jeff, how badly damaged is that car?
Well, right now, Dick, we're pretty well tore up.
He's talking to his driver right now. We'll give him a moment to talk to Darrell. They're having a conversation. The car is badly damaged. Both the back end and the front end of the car. Here's Jeff back again with us.
Right now, Dick, you know, as you can pretty well see, we got tore up pretty bad in that wreck, but I believe we got a bent ball joint. We realigned the toe on the car, and the car is driving pretty decent. We're having a little trouble getting the car to cut in the middle of the corner, so I say the caster's knocked out of line. We're going to work on the car to the next caution flag. Darrell's getting a lot of sand, a lot of heat inside the car from some inner crust panels that have been bent around, but I believe if we just get another caution here in the next few laps, we can get him pretty competitive. You know, I told him to hang in there and stay tough and try to keep that pack right there in sight. Maybe we'll be able to salvage a pretty decent finish.
Now that's the definition of optimism. Jerry punches at the other end of pit road. Jerry?
Well, not overly optimistic here. Travis Carter in the Stoll Bandit crew. Travis, your driver took a heck of a lick out there. How bad is the car?
Well, Jerry, of course it damaged the front end aerodynamically real bad, but I don't know. It just didn't seem to want to run after that. Of course, with the air blowing across the front end, the car wouldn't run. Hard to drive, and he felt like it had broken something in the transmission or something when it took that lick, and he had a terrible vibration, and he just didn't feel real good about that either. It's a shame. We felt like we were in excellent shape this race. The car was working probably the best it's worked probably all year, and as well as we've been here in the past, and we were really looking forward to this race, but it's just one of many. We'll be back.
Well, Harry Gant needed a win and wanted a win, but he is now taking the car back to the garage area.
There's Davey Allison, who leads this race. Darrell Walter, by the way, is 15th. And Gary Hammond talked about the fact that they're going to bring the car in and perhaps adjust the camber on it. Now, what does that mean?
Well, they were talking about caster and camber. That when a ball joint bends, that holds the front wheel in alignment. When that is bent, you can't readjust that alignment without changing the ball joint. It would be it wouldn't be a very good idea to try and change one during a race. So they do the best they can, and then they tell the driver, just go out there and hang in there.
There has been some tremendous racing back in the pack. You see Bill Elliott coming into the picture there. That's Alan Kulwicki's car that we're watching. He's following a little farther back, but there has been just tremendous racing by about a dozen cars back there. Elliott got by a moment ago. Here's Alan Kulwicki now moving on the inside of Rodney Combs, and look how close they run together. And look, I'll tell you, when you get up there beside the car, you can feel the movement of the car. The air actually has something to do with that, and that's why we saw the cars moving around. Alan Kulwicki was not able to get around Rodney Combs.
Boy, Alan Kulwicki and Rodney Combs put on a heck of a race there. You can see the back end of Rodney's car. It isn't sticking very well, but he's still standing on the gas, and Kulwicki probably is facing the same problem. Not much grip in the turns.
Rodney Combs running 12th. And the number 7 car of Alan Kulwicki is 13th. You saw the cars approach there, the Ernie Irvin car, which was going very slow on the racetrack and out of the groove, but it gave you a perspective of just the tremendous difference in the speed and how close or how quickly you close down on a car when he's not up to speed.
You close in a hurry here, and I'll tell you, that can be a problem, too, in traffic when you're lapping other cars. A lot of them have run up on slower cars going into turn 3 and just have to jam their brakes on, and you can lose a second or so just by having to lift on the accelerator or touching your brakes one time.
You can see the turbulence created from Bobby's car shaking that back window. That's a reinforcement strap on the plexiglass window. His crew chief has put one in the middle support there, but the two outer supports, I'm sure after his crew chief watches this race, next week you'll see supports on the two outer straps also.
That's Bobby Allison, I believe, right behind Alan Kulwicki. Now we look at the view that he has from the out the front of the car, and he's running in some pretty clean air at the moment.
He did get around Rodney Combs, and now Bobby Allison's coming up too.
Combs is running strong. I'm really impressed with that driver.
Oh yeah, got in a little too deep that time,
but got a little high.
He gained some valuable experience there. You know, he's a driver that'll at least try and find out where the edge is.
This is a racetrack that is unique in its rookie status, because the rookies are required to take a test before they are actually allowed to qualify for an event.
Yeah, isn't that something? You remember when they gave AJ Boyce
yeah.
the rookie test?
Not too long ago.
And they're not permitted to qualify in the first round of
right.
qualifying. Any rookie driver, first time here at Darlington, you can't qualify on that first day. And AJ Boyce, who's won Indianapolis, what, 4 times?
Yeah.
Couldn't do it.
All right, Davey Allison is continuing to be the leader.
You know, an impressive run so far by Mark Martin, also in a Ford, running second and still holding his ground. Jeff Bodine has kind of leveled off now. He hasn't been gaining on the leader lately.
And we're beginning to see now Dale Earnhardt come up from the middle of the pack after the pit stop. He moves to the inside and passes Benny Parsons, so that means that Dale Earnhardt in the GM Goodrich Chevrolet has moved to fifth position. Benny Parsons with a tremendous run last weekend in Atlanta. Boy, there were lots of people, including myself, who thought that man had a chance of winning the race, but unfortunately he ran out of fuel. Oh, there's debris on the racetrack and a yellow flag is out.
That's what we call in the pit area. We call that the Frenchman on the backstretch, although this may be the front stretch. Debris on the backstretch is one of the... Yeah, that is the front stretch there.
But it's going to bring out our third caution period of the afternoon.
And could be a break for Davey Allison. He perhaps had another 10 or 15 laps till he was going to have to come into the pits for a pit stop. So now he'll be able to do it under caution conditions.
All right, Gary, 65 laps into the race now. What's the strategy of a crew chief at this point?
Well, that is... In Davey Allison's case, it was about time to stop. But 65 laps is pretty much, you pretty much know where you stand. You know where the competitors are. You know they were strung out there. You make your adjustments based on what your driver says. And there's almost all the teams are going to be making stagger adjustments to the tires, trying to get a little better. Maybe Davey Allison's going to be telling his crew, yeah, this is good. Everything looks good.
All up and down pit road, they're ready for their teams to come in. Almost every team on the racetrack has a sign man out. The first guy down pit road is Davey Allison. Right behind him is Jeff Bodine. They are ready to change. Oh, Davey pulled into the wrong pit. He pulled into Lake Speed's pit. He has recovered. He is now in his pit. This will be a four-tire change. Earnhardt is also in. Bodine, a four-tire change. Kulwicki in. Lake Speed in. Just about everybody's in. About the only one on the racetrack now is the pace car. This whole place is a madhouse right now. Air wrenches everywhere. Let's see who's going to be the first one out. Jerry is with Dale Earnhardt. Jerry?
Right side tires have already been placed on the Earnhardt Chevrolet. Now left side tires going out. He's out of the way. Good pit stop as Bodine pulls out. Earnhardt is out. Bodine back down pit road. And Davey Allison gets out of Earnhardt.
Heck of a stop there for Davey Allison's crew after missing the pit and really stopping in the wrong pit, then having to accelerate down three or four pits to get to his place. Dale Earnhardt, I'm surprised, is pitting that far down pit road. You know, the ideal pit at this track especially is closer to turn one towards the exit of pit road, somewhere around an area where Jeff Bodine is pitting. That gives you a little bit of a break.
So the man who won the race out of the pits, Jeff Bodine. However, there were some that did not pit, so the standings are scrambled. We'll be back to sort it all out after these messages. Stay with us. Fans gathered here at Darlington. Pit stops have just been completed here at Darlington. And it's very rare that we're able to show you a pit stop from an in-car camera, but we are now in an ESPN Trackback. Trackbacks are brought to you by the Robert Bosch Corporation, makers of Bosch Platinum, the ultimate spark plug.
Here comes Cale Yarborough and the Hardy's Oldsmobile for a pit stop. He gets the windshield clean, something cool to drink. One crew member reaches inside to make a chassis adjustment. The jack goes up for the right side tires to be changed. The first 11-gallon can of gas goes in. Jackman heads for the left side. Second can of gas goes in. All four tires are changed. Cale waits for the signal to go. His signal is when all gas is in and the jackman lowers the car. He accelerates out of the pits. Two tire changes take about 15 seconds. Four tire changes around 25 seconds.
Our demonstration driver, Cale Yarborough, gets up to speed, and here is the field getting up to speed. We might mention that Cale, although this is his hometown and his home racetrack, so to speak, has chosen not to compete here this afternoon. At Hardy's Oldsmobile, of course, under the direction of Dale Jarrett.
And they just made a mistake on this caution period, Bob. He came into the pits too early. He lost a lap. He's running a lap down right behind the leader, Mark Martin, at the moment.
Mark Martin is the leader. Rodney Combs running in second position, or is he? Not anymore. There's Jeff Bodine going inside and passing Rodney for second.
You know, we talked about Jeff Bodine winning the race out of the pits, but we didn't think about Mark Martin running second when the yellow came out. His pits are on the back straightaway. He was able, on the back straightaway is a better place to pit if you are the leader. You can get in and out and beat the leader who may be pitting on the front stretch. If you're one of the lead cars, definitely you want to pit on the back stretch, but NASCAR doesn't like you to do that.
Inside the Dale Jarrett car, how do they choose where and when exactly the location of their pits, Gary?
Well, you know, NASCAR has realized that the back straightaway pits will give you an advantage if you're one of the front cars. As we watch Jeff Bodine going by, you know, everybody wants to pit on the back stretch, so NASCAR says you got to be out of the top 20 in points to get a back straightaway pit. Then they go by the defending champion gets his first choice of pits. Obviously, he'll be on the front stretch. So Dale Earnhardt gets first choice. And then after that, they take the qualifying positions from the day of qualifying. Here comes Dale Earnhardt and Rodney Combs staying right in there. Rodney is getting put on one heck of a show so far. Look at how loose his car gets off the corner. You know, dirt track drivers are more accustomed to driving loose cars than, say, asphalt drivers.
Well, if he's trying to attract some attention for his sponsor or for his car owner or whatever, the sponsor, of course, on the car is AC Spark Plugs. He is doing it, at least in the first 72 laps.
Running in front of Dale Earnhardt at Darlington, it's got to be something he's been dreaming about for a long time.
Yeah, he isn't anymore.
Earnhardt's car is working very well. When you can pass somebody between turns three and four, the way he just passed Rodney Combs, that means your car is working very well. Here's Lake Speed trying to move down on the inside. Looks like his car is working well, too, and so is Davey Allison.
Yeah, we haven't seen much from Lake Speed so far, but here he comes.
Davey Allison passing Rodney Combs, and now Lake Speed also trying to move to the inside along with Rusty Wallace. They won't make the pass at the moment. Let's go to Dick Bergman.
Well, Bob, this pile of junk I'm surrounded by used to be the front end of Rick Wilson's automobile. These guys have been working since the absolute beginning of the race. They've replaced the whole front end on this car. Ball joints, A-frames, lower control arms. Look at this, they got an improvised grill. The hood is gone, the front bumper's all pushed back. But behind the wheel, the driver, Rick Wilson, ready to go back in it. He doesn't want to miss a single point, but I'm going to tell you what, this thing is beat up.
A lot of times when a car will be damaged like that, it'll come back out on the racetrack and look like a modified. That thing doesn't even look like a modified. I don't know what you would call that.
Boy, it's a mess. You hate to do it as a crew. You don't want, you just, you know, you come to win. You don't come here to fix an old wreck and go out there and ride around. But the points are always in the back of your mind. You've got to do it. It's something you don't want to do, but you got to do it.
Mark Martin in the Jack Roush prepared Stroll Light Ford leads the Trans South 500, but Jeff Bodine is catching.
He is moving in very quickly. Bodine's car has run strong all day. Of course, he led earlier, then after making a pit stop, had to fight his way back up through, but he had a good pit stop this time around. The car is hooked up, and here he goes, getting towards the lead.
Our Pit Central reporter is Larry Newber.
Well, Bob, remember at the top of the show we talked about how seldom in the history of this race has someone who started outside the top 10 won this race. But we could see history in the making here today. We've been talking about Rodney Combs. Now, these positions right here, running positions on the track, are something that we charted during the pit stop. So they have all been scrambled. Rodney has been closer to the top 5 in the 12th position that this indicates. But look at the starting position, 36. We saw Greg Sachs running near the front earlier. He was in fourth position at the time, having started in 33rd. And Benny Parsons, the 28th starter, was running in the fifth. All the other people who started in the top 10, with the exception of Schrader, you can see were running about where we expected them. Kubica is showing a little stronger than this 13th. Again, this was something charted during the last pit stop segment. But you can see that old analogy that you've got to start in the top 10 here in order to win at Darlington may be a little bit in jeopardy here today.
I think you're right, Larry, and Jeff Bodine is challenging Mark Martin for the lead right now, and a recheck of NASCAR scoring shows that Rodney Combs is a lap down, so he's not contesting for positions up there with the leaders, but nevertheless, the car is working very well for Rodney Combs.
And I think what he did, made the same mistake as Dale Jarrett's crew did. They came into the pits on the backstretch too early, and the caution car got around before they got out of the pits.
All right, a pit stop summary now from the most recent set of pit stops. Davey Allison came into the pits first, came out fourth. There you can see Mark Martin moved up a position. Jeff Bodine stayed the same, and Dale Earnhardt stayed the same. But at the moment, it is Jeff Bodine who is beginning now to move in and to present a challenge to the Mark Martin car for the lead.
Yeah, Jeff is sure showing his muscles. He's got a strong car. It looks like it's handling good on the turns, also strong down the straightaway. You know, he runs a lot higher groove, if we can watch him going into turn one, than Mark Martin. He's up there close to that Darlington stripe when he gets into the middle of one and two. A lot higher than Mark Martin.
This is the second day in a row that Jeff Bodine has had a good run. Yesterday he won the Busch Grand National race. He beat Harry Gant, Dale Jarrett, Dale Earnhardt, Bobby Hillen Jr., Rob Moroso, Larry Pearson, Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin, and Darrell Walton. Those were the top 10 finishers in yesterday's Country Squire Homes 200.
You know, I worked with Jeff Bodine here for 2 years, and this is probably one of his better tracks. There he goes for the lead, going into turn one. He's running a different line than Mark Martin, but Mark will probably pick up on that line now when he gets a chance to follow Jeff.
So, Gary, in working with Jeff Bodine, he, of course, built modified cars, engineered modified cars. He seems to know a lot about a race car and what he wants it to do.
Well, he is very precise on what he wants. When that car is right and he likes it, nobody in the world can touch him. It's the hard part with Jeff is getting that car perfect, and he is a perfectionist. He is one heck of a race driver. I think if he can continue with no mechanical problems today, he's going to be a contender at the end.
Bodine is our fifth different leader of the afternoon. We have had 5 lead changes. The Xerex car of Alan Kulwicki is right behind that of Rodney Combs. And a little bit of bumping, it looked like there, some contact.
Looks like they did touch just a little bit, so Kulwicki moves on around pretty easily this time.
Yeah, that was the third turn there. It's only one wide there if you're racing at the racing speed going into turn three.
It's Bodine, Mark Martin, Dale Earnhardt, Davey Allison, then Rusty Wallace. Lake Speed is sixth. Bill Elliott is seventh. Then the number 90 car of Benny Parsons is running eighth, followed by Sterling Marlin. And the number 12 car, driven by Bobby Allison, is shown in 10th position. There you can see Jeff Bodine is the leader with 83 out of 367 laps completed. Mark Martin second. Dale Earnhardt is running in third. Then Davey Allison fourth, followed by Rusty Wallace. We'll be back with more of the Trent. Bob Jenkins, Ned Jarrett, Gary Nelson, Larry Newber, Dick Bergman, and Jerry Punch back at Darlington International Raceway for the Trans-South 500. And with 88 laps completed, the lead is held by Jeff Bodine, but there in second position is the number six car, driven by Mark Martin. The crew chief on the car is Steve Meehl, and wait a minute, here is Dale Earnhardt making a pit stop. We'll talk more about the Mark Martin situation in a moment, but here is Earnhardt in for an unscheduled stop.
Looks like a right rear tire flat. They're definitely looking at it. It looked like it was wobbling a little bit coming in. You know, you do lose a lap here. If you're not quite the leader, when you make a pit stop for two tires, you're going to come out a lap down. So we'll see where Earnhardt comes out.
Although it's only a 12.3-second pit stop, it looks like that Earnhardt is having trouble getting back up to speed. Ned, what does this do to a driver psychologically?
I'll tell you, it really deflates you momentarily. Of course, Earnhardt runs very strong here, and he feels that he'd have a good chance to get it back. But apparently, there's something wrong with the transmission in that car, and it perhaps only has fourth gear, and going out of the pits very slowly, he did go a lap down.
Yeah, definitely a lap down, only a lap and a half down. He didn't get accelerated good. He stayed on the apron around the first and second turn. Now he's still not up to speed going into turn three. He looks like he's got a major problem.
Certainly does, and we'll keep an eye on that situation. But Dale Earnhardt may have a problem, and if that's a continuing problem, it'll hurt him all afternoon long. Let's go to Dick Bergman.
And I'm on a very happy pit crew right now with Steve Meehl. Mark Martin is his driver. And Steve, this is the first time you've led. Right now you're in second, but you did have the lead. You must be happy.
Well, we're pretty pleased with how the car's working right now. On the last set of tires, we took off under that caution. We saw higher temperatures than we were anticipating this early in the race. So we backed Mark off a little bit, which is not to say he can go ahead and lead when he wants, but we're interested in running our race. We're going to let the other guys run their race.
That's Steve Meehl. He's crew chief. By the way, this car owner who built the engine in the car is Jack Roush, famous for sports car racing. Jerry Punch?
Oh. We're standing with the car owner of Dale Earnhardt, Richard Childers. And Richard, an unscheduled stop. What happened?
Just cut a right rear tire.
He's awfully slow coming back to speed. Is there a problem with the car?
No, we just got some gas under the left rear tire. He's all right, Jerry. Just cut that right rear tire down on the track.
Well, a tough break early on for Dale Earnhardt here. He loses the lap, believe it.
And how easy is it to make up a lap here, Ned?
Well, it's not very easy to make up a lap here. However, Earnhardt, as fast as he runs on this racetrack, if a caution should come out, he would be able to go down on the inside and, of course, beside of the leader on a restart. And if he's fast enough, he can pass him, get another caution, and he can be right back in it.
Well, it really was a surprise that Dale came in when he did, but I will tell you that still, despite the apparent problem with the soft right rear tire, there is no team in this pit area that gets more confidence as a potential winner here today than the number three car. Also, a lot of sentiment for Rusty Wallace at number 27. There were people who liked Jeff Bodine, but he's had such bad luck the last couple of years that nobody thinks he's a really good candidate. Remember, it's been almost 2 years, Gary Nelson, since Jeff has won a race.
Well, it's interesting. You know, here's Jeff Bodine and Mark Martin. Jeff just barely opening up a little bit of the gap, but Mark Martin keeping him in full view.
As a matter of fact, Jeff Bodine's last win was at Dover in May of 1986. Go back and pick up on some of the action behind, and this is Lake Speed and Rusty Wallace, who have been going at a tooth and nail out there for several laps, and now it is Lake Speed who has moved to fourth. Rusty Wallace is fifth, and right behind him, of course, is the
Dale Earnhardt car, who is a lap down. Bill Elliott is the next car in position. Bill is currently running in sixth position. In fact, for a while, Bill Elliott was gaining on the Lake Speed and Rusty Wallace, but now he has dropped back a little bit from them, whether he's just sort of riding and let them go about their battle up there, or if maybe he just can't do any better at this time.
Well, Lake Speed is one of those 13 drivers that began the race on Hoosier tires. There's Rusty Wallace, and then right behind Rusty is Dale Earnhardt. 13 drivers began the race on Hoosier tires, including Rick Wilson, Lake Speed, Harry Gant, Morgan Shepherd, Sterling Marlin, Brad Teague, Ken Bouchard, Buddy Baker, Eddie Bierschwale, Neil Bonnet, Michael Waltrip, Bobby Hillen, and Derek Cope.
You know Earnhardt there, they nicknamed him Ironhead. That nickname came from this racetrack where Bill Gasaway, who used to be the competition director for NASCAR, watched Earnhardt drive the first couple times Earnhardt ever came here. And after watching him, he named him Ironhead, and it stuck with him since. The way he attacks this track is different from anybody else. He's a lap down here. He knows there's a long way to go, but he's trying for every inch. He's going to get around every car he can and hope something happens for him. He needs a break right now.
Lake Speed in the Kmart Oldsmobile, passing the number 52 car of Jimmy Means, who moves over and allows the faster car to pass to the outside. Look at this, three abreast through there as Earnhardt went high and Wallace went low to pass Jimmy Means.
You're not supposed to do that, but there's old Ironhead. That's why he got his nickname, those kind of moves.
I'll tell you, that was a very brave move. But he's a brave soul.
Yeah, right?
And he's surviving.
Yeah, he does it time after time. He puts on a show everywhere he races. He is worth the price of admission, I think, just by himself.
Rusty Wallace also performing well, though, in fifth position in the Kodiak Pontiac car number 27. Let's look again at this three abreast through turn three.
Well, you can see Rusty Wallace goes to the inside. Earnhardt goes right up next to the wall, and Jimmy Means just holds his line in the middle. Good thing he did hold his line.
Yeah, we complimented Rusty for saving the car through there and Earnhardt, but also Jimmy Means did just exactly what he was supposed to, and that is hold the line.
Yeah, the leaders catch you so quick when you're one of the lap-down cars or the slower traffic. The leaders catch you before you even see them in your mirror. Then the thing to do is exactly what Jimmy Means did, hold his line.
Neil Bonnet is being passed and put another lap down by Jeff Bodine, so the driver who won two consecutive Winston Cup races earlier this year is having problems today. And there is Terry Labonte, who has been in the pit area for many, many laps after being involved in one of our early multi-car crashes. The repairs have apparently been made to Budweiser Chevrolet, and Terry Labonte is working back up to speed on the backstretch and re-entering the Trans-South 500.
They did a good job on Labonte's car, Junior Johnson's crew. All the fenders and the hood and everything is still on there. The car looks to be intact. We'll see how he runs.
101 laps are completed out of 367. We are live at Darlington International Raceway for the Trans-South 500. Darlington International Raceway, where Jeff Bodine is the leader and Dale Earnhardt is in for the second time in just a few laps.
Yeah, left side tires this time. He got rights and they thought they had the problems out, but I got a feeling his problems are worse than tires. I think he may have some major problems.
Let's see if he has as much difficulty getting up to speed this time.
Looks like he's going out much faster this time than he did the time before, so apparently it's not a transmission problem. Richard Chilvers said he just got some gas on the tires there before, and he's going right out up in front of Rick Wilson. Rick Wilson, who has gone back out on the racetrack with his car looking like a modified or something from a different century. But anyway, Earnhardt slid right up in front of and took off.
All right, Jeff Bodine leads at the end of 103 laps. He has led 40 of the 103 circuits. The average speed is 113.965. We have had four different caution periods for a total of 26 laps, five leaders and five lead changes, and at the moment there are 17 cars on the lead lap. For a summary of the tire situation, let's go to Pit Central.
Well, Bob, that's been a major part of the Winston Cup story in 1988. In the early part of the season, Neil Bonnet threatened to make a shambles of the story. He was winning all the races. Well, here is an update on today. Recall back at Rockingham, the last Winston Cup race, this board was about 5-5. Five Goodyear people running in the top 10, five Hoosier all day long. But today, Goodyear is really taking the measure of Hoosier tires. The one possible reason, we don't really have a good fix on which tire is incredibly superior to the other one, if there is indeed that situation today, is the crash early on. Remember that big crash that took out many of the front-running cars? Rick Wilson, Harry Gant, Neil Bonnet, and Sterling Marlin were all involved. Now, Sterling Marlin has made a comeback. He's moved back up in the seventh position, but Goodyear tires are having a very strong day. What's the situation right now out on pit road, Jerry Punch?
We're standing in the Jeff Bodine pit, Larry, and I'm with Waddell Wilson, who's the crew chief and the engine builder for Jeff Bodine. And Waddell, you've got to be awfully pleased about the way the car's running, but are you concerned at all about the quick pace he's been setting early on?
You know, we're happy with the car. We're still adjusting on it some. It's not exactly where he wants it yet, but you know, Darlington is a racetrack you just off and on all day.
Given the fact that Earnhardt's been so strong here, did you sigh a little bit of relief to see that he's already a lap or so down?
Well, you know, you always have to worry about Earnhardt. And you know him, he can possibly come back and make up the laps he's lost. So, you know, you never count him out as long as he's on the racetrack.
Well, indeed he can. Earnhardt's awfully strong, and Dick Bergeron is standing by in the Earnhardt pits. Dick?
I'm cheering for Dale Earnhardt to win. He's going to need a little luck, and right now his luck is lousy. He did, in fact, have a right rear tire go down. He apparently cut it. Then the car started to vibrate and shake. A left rear tire equalized. Having two things like that happen so quickly, one right after another, it's just flat bad luck. Earnhardt is running short today.
And that's one thing that you can work all month on or all week long trying to prepare a car, and Earnhardt just doesn't have the luck when he needs it this year, and that may be the difference between his success the last 2 years and this year. That was one of the things that he told us about when we interviewed him for Speed Week. There were just several things that have meant that he's not doing as well this year, and luck is one of them. You can see how loose the car is here as it came out of corner number four.
The back end does get around quite a bit on him as he comes out of that turn. You can see there, but Earnhardt, you know, that doesn't bother him that much. He just turns that steering wheel, wrestles it right on around, and keeps it going.
Gary, what do they do to correct that situation?
Well, you know, you got to work with your tire stagger in the back. If you try and put your biggest tires on the left rear, bigger than what you have, and your smaller ones on the right rear, to get the left rear tire to get more of a grip. And hopefully the right rear tire won't have to work so hard, and maybe the car won't slide so much. But those kind of problems like that are pretty tough to correct when it's that severe. You know, Earnhardt is having his problems today, more so than usual.
You know, one thing that I think warrants a comment here from Ned. You watch these cars as they come down the straightaway, they're at full speed, and it appears to us from up here in the booth and probably to you people at home watching that they really don't get on the brakes and don't slow down much for the corners here, but they do, don't they, Ned?
Yes, they have to decelerate quite a bit, more so going into turn one than they do going into turn three. The turn is much shorter. This is an egg-shaped racetrack, and when you go into turn number one down here, you got a lot of speed as you come off of turn four, so you got a lot going into that turn. So you do have to decelerate and actually brake a little bit going into that turn. Now, going into turn three, normally you don't use that much brakes going in there. You just decelerate, get the car set, and then try to accelerate all the way through to turns three and four.
In terms of miles an hour, how much do they slow from the top speed at the end of the straightaway until they get back on it going for the backstretch?
Kenny Schrader, of course, set a new track record in qualifying here at 162 miles an hour. That's the average speed around the racetrack. That means that he had to be running 175, 180 miles an hour on the straightaway because he'd slow down to perhaps 140 in the turns. So you're going at a pretty good clip when you get there. And Bob, let me mention that Benny Parsons has had trouble with car number 90. He was up in the top five for a long time, and it looks like he's out of the race. He was running in ninth before he took it to the pits.
Indeed, he has pulled out of the race onto the backstretch. Now in sixth and seventh position, Bill Elliott there in the number nine Coors Belling Ford, and the 44 car of Sterling Marlin. They are battling for sixth position as they pass Eddie Bierschwehl at the top of the racetrack.
Oh, Bill Elliott, this is one of his best tracks, like I said earlier. He's just fighting his time. You know, he's within, he's on the same straightaway as the leader. He's only about 10 seconds behind. He's just taking it easy.
The 14 cars still in the lead lap at this point of the race. Of course, Jeff Bodine, the leader, second place, and Mark Martin, third, is Davey Allison. Davey had been moving up on the leaders, but he's sort of stabilized now. In the fourth position is Late Speed. Fifth is Rusty Wallace. Bill Elliott, sixth. Sterling Marlin, seventh. Bobby Allison, eighth. The car number 50 of Greg Sachs is ninth. Alan Kowicki is running 10th. Bill Parsons is 11th. Buddy Baker is 12th. Ricky Rudd is 13th. And Darrell Waltrip is 14th. But Jeff Bodine is now moving up on Waltrip, Rudd, and Baker. They're not too far from going a lap down.
But those 14 cars are on the lead lap at the moment. Now, Sterling Marlin began the race on Hoosier tires. However, we understand he has some good years in his pit, so that perhaps if we get a late caution flag, he will put on the Goodyears, thinking that perhaps those tires will be better for a shorter length of time.
Well, you know, that there's another wrinkle to the strategy the crew chiefs have to go through. I've never myself been able to been in a race where they had different tires, but if the tires are quicker and the crew chief thinks they are, he's allowed to change brands one time during the race, and he can't change back. So that'll be a decision for Jake Elder to make later in the race.
Well, Gary, he is not the only one a number of people who started this race on Hoosier tires, namely Harry Gant. They also have good years in the pits. Eddie Bierschwall has two sets of good years. By the way, they're on the red rim, so if you see those out on the racetrack. And Bobby Hillen Jr. started the race on Hoosiers, also had good years mounted. We saw a couple of teams change at the last race at Atlanta. Oh, by the way, Davey Allison also was another one who had Hoosiers ready to go. Harry Gant was one team that changed at the Atlanta race, but unfortunately, the car wasn't competitive enough to find out whether or not it made a difference.
All right, Larry, and we have a battle for the lead shaping up as Mark Martin really put the heat on Bodine there for a while, but now the interval expands.
Well, he backed off just momentarily as he went around Dale Jarrett going into that turn. Very wisely, Mark Martin didn't go in there too fast and create any type of situation, but Martin has caught up with Jeff Bodine, but now they're in some heavy traffic.
There's Dale Jarrett's car trailing, passing the 22 car, Steve Moore.
You can almost see the blind spot going in that first turn from the sun on the windshield, the glare. And this is early in the afternoon. As the day wears on, that glare gets worse and worse. There's so much sand on the surface of this track. The sand may not be blowing like you would think a sandstorm, but it's being kicked up, and you're going 140, 50 miles an hour when you hit the sand. Causes the windshield to get hit. It really cuts down on your vision.
Let's just take a lap here with Dale, and we'll hear what it's like to watch and to listen a lap at Darlington. Parsons has spun. I believe it's at the turn two entrance to the backstretch. Don't think he hit anything, did he?
Well, he's able to come on around. He has the car corrected and is coming on around, so apparently he didn't hit anything too hard.
Will it create a caution?
Yes, it has brought the caution out.
Darrell Waltrip just was about to get lapped when the caution came out.
In fact, he had gotten lapped, but I believe he's going to get it back as he comes off of turn four. He has passed Jeff Bodine. Now Dale Jarrett racing Jeff Bodine around trying to get one of his two laps back.
And there you can see that Bodine, I believe, crossed the stripe ahead of Dale.
And I believe he got back by Darrell Waltrip as well.
I think he did too.
Surprising that Waltrip had slowed down. Now, it's possible. I don't think they got the caution flag the last time around. If they did, well, then it was wise for Waltrip to back off.
This could be interesting. Here's Davey Allison and Dale Earnhardt in the pits with the leader still on the track, although they're running slow. We'll have to see if they get trapped here. Bodine is going slow enough. I don't think it's going to happen. Davey may have pitted too early, but if he can get out before Bodine comes around, he'll be all right. This is going to be the question mark right about here. Yeah, he got away. Okay.
The caution car is about to go out, and it moves out in front of Davey Allison, but it'll pick up the car, whoever was behind Jeff Bodine, so Davey is able to move on around it as all the leaders come down pit road.
Boy, that was close, though. Davey almost lost a lap. Jerry Punch is in Bodine's pit.
Jeff Bodine's crew now working to change right side tires. They were a little bit concerned about Davey Allison coming in. They wanted Jeffrey to come down pit road last time by. And Jeff Bodine's crew now having right side tires on will come around and change left side. So fresh rubber all the way around, cleaning the windshield. Waddell Wilson rolls that front tire up there. He will go up and scrub the windshield down. Really pleased the way Jeff Bodine's running the car. Good pit stop, four tires. He's down and away.
And right behind him is going to be Lake Speed, followed by Rusty Wallace, then Bill Elliott, Bobby Allison. Here comes Bobby Hillen Jr., and Sterling Marlin also pulls out.
Well, it gets hectic in the pits there. That's a good camera angle. You can see all the teams. They got to dodge the tires. They got to dodge the crew members. Here's somebody working on their car. It looks like a modified with no fender or hood or front end, but that's Rick Wilson's car, the Kodak car. It looks like they're working underneath it now.
123 laps are completed. Caution flag is out again because of a spin involving Phil Parsons in turn number two. He is enjoying themselves, and with 125 laps into the race, it is Mark Martin who leads in the number six Stroh's Light Ford. That's Dale Jarrett in 29 behind. However, he is a lap down. The second car is Davey Allison. He is shown in second position. In third place is Jeff Bodine. And in fourth is Lake Speed. Now we're being told that Greg Sachs, there in the number 50 car, is the leader. I don't think he made a pit stop, or did he? Well, in any case, he is shown as the leader. Now, Earnhardt is up there in front of Sachs. What's the deal there?
Well, that's where Earnhardt should be. Well, no, he's two laps down. He should be low. If you were one down, you would be technically in the lead lap. Earnhardt, you know, it's a courtesy thing. He should be down low.
Well, in any case, the green flag comes back out, and the race resumes.
It's not really a rule that tells the lap down cars to get on a low groove. It's a courtesy thing. NASCAR tells the drivers in the driver's meeting, look, the shoe will be on the other foot someday. You should give the courtesy. But Earnhardt took the outside line and got a jump. We'll see how it pays off.
Well, that got one of the laps down back that he was down. If he could get another caution and then get back in the same position again, he could get back in this thing.
Turn number one, that's Greg Sachs, the number 50 car, leading the way. Mark Martindale on the inside.
Close race.
The scoreboard is showing Mark Martin as the leader, but our scoring indicates that Greg Sachs is. Sachs is the leader at this point. There's Davey Allison, though, in third, and Jeff Bodine in fourth.
Mark Martin now about to make a move on Greg Sachs, and does. Ooh. As he comes off of turn four. Good move.
A little scary, but he made it.
But look at Davey Allison coming on through there. Took both of them.
I guess that's the place to pass, huh, on the straightaway?
It's the safest place, but it's the hardest.
But Mark Martin doesn't want much of that. He wants to lead back.
Into turn number three, Martin has the inside line. Let's see what shakes out. He takes the lead momentarily, but watch the car slide high. Allison is right there to bid for the lead, but not this time.
Well, back in the 60s when I was driving a race car, you couldn't do much side-by-side racing at Darlington. In fact, you could not pass between turns three and four at all. The track has been changed some since then, which permits them to do what we have seen here in the last couple of laps. You had to set a driver up, pass him coming off of turn four, and if you were brave enough, try to pass him between turns one and two.
Boy, you know, Waddell Wilson was talking earlier with Dick Bergman about how Jeff wasn't exactly satisfied with the car. If they get that thing right, he's going to be gone.
Yeah, I don't see how they can get it much more right. I mean, he's doing all right. So Bodine now is in second position, having dropped Davey Allison back to third. Mark Martin, however, in without question his most impressive Winston Cup performance to date, is the leader. And here is the pit stop summary. Jeff Bodine in first, out fourth. Mark Martin stayed the same, so did Davey Allison. Lake Speed came in fourth, out fifth. And Greg Sachs, who came in ninth position, came out in the lead, but he, of course, has dropped back now since then. But Sachs definitely did pick up the most ground there on his pit stop, lap number 122.
And he might have done what Bill Elliott did earlier, only take on two tires to try to get himself back up there as far as he could.
Yeah, that's one of the decisions a crew has to make. How many laps are on our tires? Can we gamble on only rights, or maybe just gas only and go back out there and get the car up towards the front?
Of course, you sacrifice a little bit of speed if you don't put all four tires on, because new tires on this racetrack and most racetracks, as a matter of fact, will run faster than the heated up tires.
One of the things you also have is the most likely time to pick up something in your tire is when you make your pit stop. So many times during races, we would take tires off of a car that had holes in them and were slowly going down. And that was things that the hot tires would pick up entering the pit.
Mark Martin still maintaining that advantage over Jeff Bodine. I believe Martin is real. He has certainly been able to hold his own. Timing a lap now to see what the time and speed report is going to be. Remember, Ken Schrader's pole sitting speed was 162.657 miles an hour.
They won't be running that fast now. Now, that was 30.23 seconds, the fastest that anyone has ever gone around this Darlington Raceway. They'll probably be running about 32 and a half seconds now. Yeah. We'll see in a moment.
32.2.
Pretty close, Ned.
And an hour calculator. And that's 152.720 miles an hour. So almost 10 miles an hour, a little over 10 miles an hour slower than the top qualifying speed.
Earnhardt is lucky to be able to hold his position ahead of Mark Martin there. If he can do that and a caution come out, he'll get one of the two laps back that he needs. He still is two laps, technically almost two laps down. He's one and like seven-eighths of a lap down right now.
Well, what's the strategy of Jeff Bodine, Ned? Is he content right there at the moment?
Could be. He could be content, but he knows there's still a long way to go in this race. You don't take any unnecessary chances, and maybe Mark Martin is running a little bit harder than Jeff chooses to run at this point, and he's just going to sort of ride here for a while. Let's go to Dick Berger and then Dale Earnhardt's pitch.
Well, here's where we'll find out what Earnhardt's strategy is. I'm with his crew chief. What are you guys going to do?
Well, we're not too hot so far, are we? First of all, we got to work on getting the laps back. And in order to do that, we got to run faster than the leader, and that's not the easiest thing in the world to do.
How stable is that car, Kirk? Is that thing a handful, or is it all right?
Slippery right now. We've been working with it here all morning.
You're not giving up, are you?
No, not yet.
These guys never give up. Never, ever, ever.
Well, Nick, he was able to pull away from Mark Martin on the restart, but right now it looks like that Martin is beginning to close in a little bit on Earnhardt. Of course, he'd like to do that and get him two laps down because he knows how tough he can be.
You know, I've been in this position a lot of times, and that the driver knows that the leader's coming to put him another lap down. He starts looking around on the track, and he'll see things on the racetrack, and he'll call on the radio and say, hey, there's debris on the back straightaway, or debris in the turn. Tell NASCAR about it. See if we can get a caution. They try anything to get that caution lap.
Mark Martin and Jeff Bodine, first and second. Third is Davey Allison. There is Rodney Combs of the 97 AC spark plug machine coming into the pits. Looks like there may be some smoke coming from the rear end of that car, but Rodney gave it a heck of a run.
Well, had an awfully good run, and Darrell Waltrip has just gone off of the pace coming off of turn four. He'll be coming down pit road as we see Rodney Combs in the pits, and here comes Darrell Waltrip, an unscheduled pit stop for the three-time NASCAR Winston Cup champion.
I'll show you something. See the deck lid on that car, how it's pushed up. They made a pit stop and they stuck something under the deck lid to try and give the car more spoiler.
But he's going to the garage area. That right. Means he's out of the race at least temporarily.
You can see the oil running out from underneath. But see how that deck lid is wedged up? They put some boards under there to try and get a bigger spoiler because the car was loose. That's not too legal. I hope they get that off. He parked right next to the NASCAR trailer too.
Okay, we're at the Trans-South 500. On this Sunday afternoon, 139 laps are completed. There are the top five. The all-time money winner in Winston Cup competition, Darrell Waltrip, is in the garage area. He has won over $8 million in Winston Cup NASCAR competition, but it's a situation where he's behind the wall at this point. Let's go down to the pits.
Darrell, what's the problem?
We lost the clutch.
You got a lot of water or oil behind the car as well. Can you continue, or is this thing over?
No, we'll just fix that, whatever. You know, that's out of the gearbox or something in the driveline. The engine's running fine. It's just redline.
Hey, you look. The crew would like us to get out of the way for obvious reasons. Darrell is obviously also tired. There's filth and dirt and debris all over the inside of this automobile. They're going to try to work on it. They're going to try to fix it to get him back in the race despite his condition. And despite the condition of the car.
So Darrell Waltrip's crew goes to work on the car, trying to fix the clutch that perhaps will allow him to return to action a little bit later. Well, the interval is staying pretty much the same. Maybe Mark Martin with just a little bit more advantage over Jeff Bodine here. And we have a race for fourth as Rusty Wallace has come on to challenge Davey Allison for that fourth position.
Boy, Rusty, we haven't talked much about him, but he's been laying right in there. There's Bill Elliott behind him. They're both driving an awful smart race, just taking the chance, taking their positions when they get a chance, not really pushing to the limit like some of the more aggressive drivers have been doing.
Well, Rusty took the advantage right there to move around Davey Allison and move into the fourth position. And talk about returning to the race. Here's Bill Elliott coming up through the pack, but returning to the race a moment ago while we were talking to Darrell Waltrip, Kenny Schrader came back out on the racetrack in a very battered race car, but they've been working on that thing, and he's going to make as many laps as he can, try to get as many Winston Cup points as he possibly can.
Well, So this is lap 145, and the wreck was awful early, so he's over 110 laps down. To get back out in the race can show you what a team wants to do to gain those points.
There is just all kinds of work going on in the Darrell Waltrip garage area as they are underneath the car and trying everything they can to get it back in the race. Here's Larry in pit central.
Well, Bob, earlier Gary was talking about those body panels, those inner body panels that were damaged in that early race wreck, causing some problems for Darrell. Here they are. It's very simple. It's just little pieces of tin, aluminum. Gary can respond to that. You can see it's just a very minor part of this race car, but it's a very major part for allowing that race driver to have the stamina to go the race long. You know, once you feel the outer body panels off of one of these 3,500-pound Winston Cup machines, it's just a bare race car. It looks simple, but there's a lot of complexities in there, and there's a lot of secrets too, aren't there, Gary?
Well, definitely, Larry. You know, right, what you're looking at there is what we call the inner panel. Jeff Hammond called it the crush panel. That goes out and covers and protects the driver from being exposed to the tires. The sand and things and debris off the track will come inside the car, smoke. But from the front inner crush panels, if they get bent or destroyed, then you get the heat from the engine coming in. As we watch Bill Elliott go by Davey Allison, we can see him moving up. But Darrell Waltrip looked awful tired when they interviewed him. He'd been sitting in that car with all of that heat from the engine compartment, all the sand from the tires pestering, peppering him on the face. He's probably feels more tired than most of these drivers on the track now.
Bodine beginning to move in once again on Mark Martin, and Jerry Punch is with Rick Hendrick.
Well, Rick, of course, owns the cars of Kenny Schrader and Darrell Waltrip and Jeff Bodine. And Rick, it's been an up-and-down day for Hendrick Motorsports. First of all, the guy that's on the pole, the guy you thought maybe had the shot to win, ends up with half a car left. You know, when Schrader came back by us on pit road, you had a big smile on your face.
I couldn't hear you, Jerry.
When Kenny Schrader came back by us on pit road, you had a big smile on your face.
It looked like a modified car. When Kenny came out, Darrell went in. I think they had some kind of problem in the transmission. So tough luck for those guys. And you know, Kenny was looking good. We thought he had a real shot at this thing. And Jeff's running good now. So this is an awful tough racetrack, I'll tell you.
Indeed, a tough track here. And Rick Hendrick, an emotional roller coaster. First it's Schrader, then it's Waltrip, and now he's here in the Jeff Bodine pit.
And Rick is going to be focusing attention right now on Jeff Bodine, one of his drivers, because Jeff is within a couple of car lengths of the leader, Mark Martin.
Oh, Jeff is doing a good job. You know, Rick is proud of all of his teams. He likes to see them all up front. You know, in a day like today where two of them have already been knocked out or pretty much out of contention, Jeff Bodine is carrying the flag for Hendrick Motorsports, and Rick is going to pay a lot of attention to what Jeff does from here out.
Mark Martin, the ASA stock car champion in 1978, 79, 80, and 86. He was runner-up in the 1982 NASCAR Winston Cup Rookie of the Year Championship, but leading today's Trans-South 500 just a few car lengths ahead of Jeff Bodine. We'll be back to continue our live coverage from Darlington International Raceway. Race still being led by Mark Martin as he is now in some heavy traffic coming down the main straightaway. That's Brett Bodine now right ahead of him. There's a car in between himself and the second place Jeff Bodine, that car being driven by Derek Cope.
Of course, Brett Bodine was involved in that early wreck when Kyle Petty blew an engine, but he has made repairs on the car. He's a few laps down, but he's been out there running good since then, and his brother Jeff about to move around on the outside. Of course, Brett gives him plenty of room to do so.
And look who's in third. That purple car, driven by Lake Speed, is in third, and now he's right on the, almost on the back bumper of Bodine, and Rusty Wallace is right there behind Lake Speed. Let's go to Jerry Punch.
You mentioned some people might be surprised about how well Mark Martin is running here, but you got to remember, you know, Mark Martin, the four-time ASA champion, as you mentioned, Bob, has run here very well in the past. In fact, one of his best career Winston Cup finishes came here in this race in 1983. He finished third driving a Buick, behind Harry Gant and Darrell Walter, but he was ran them all day long with the leader. So Mark Martin, no stranger to running well here at Darlington.
And of course, this is only the fifth race for this Jack Roush team. Back in October, they were still working on their new shop, but they put it all together, and they're being rewarded here this afternoon with that fine performance by Mark.
You know, that's an impressive run for that team. I got a feeling we're going to see more and more from that Mark Martin, Jack Roush, Steve Neal, Robin Pemberton, the whole crowd. I know them pretty well. I know the chassis engineer that helps them with the setups. He has one of the better records in the sport. The whole team has the potential to really dominate later in this season.
Historically, in Trans Am competition, Jack Roush doesn't do anything unless he does it absolutely first class.
Well, definitely, and they're going first class here in NASCAR racing. They got a lot of things going for them. Mark Martin's a good experienced driver. A lot of people don't know how many laps and miles Mark Martin has run in Winston Cup competition, but he's been racing for years and years.
Lake Speed now really putting the pressure on Jeff Bodine for second place. This is one of the longer runs we've had in a green flag competition. Are the Hoosier tires now beginning to come into play? It might be Lake Speed, of course, running the Hoosier tires, and he's putting the pressure on Jeff Bodine, who is on Goodyear.
That's a very good point. Lake has really closed in on Jeff Bodine in the last several laps, and now is right there bidding for second position.
Yeah, Jeff seems to have slipped just a little bit, although he was, maybe it's not so much that Jeff has slipped. I think Lake Speed has caught them, because Jeff and Mark Martin are running about the same as they've been for quite a while.
And we mentioned earlier that it looked like they were closing in on Earnhardt, but since then that has changed. Earnhardt has moved out to a comfortable position, perhaps 3 or 4 seconds ahead of the leader, but still remains one lap plus about four-fifths of a lap down.
Lake Speed in the number 83 car, the only one of the three on Hoosier tires. Mark Martin and Jeff Bodine on the Goodyears. Now Bodine, rather Lake Speed, looks to the inside of Bodine coming down the straightaway, but they fall into single file formation once again. There's Lake Speed in third. Let's see what happens here. Lake Speed dives to the inside, coming out of corner number two. They race down the backstretch. There is a slower car that may play a part here. And that slower car is that of Rick Wilson, but he moves down nicely. Nevertheless, Lake Speed cannot make a pass for second.
And Rusty Wallace, you can see him almost coming into the picture. There he is. He's beginning to move up a little bit now on the front runners.
So the first four cars are that close on the racetrack. There is fourth, Rusty Wallace.
That is quite a race, you know, at Darlington. It just, this place always produces kind of races like this, competition from start to finish.
Lake Speed wants to try it again. It
may have
into turn three. I believe it has it this time.
Nice move by Speed, but look at the car wash out. Nevertheless, Jeff Bodine, his car also moves high on the racetrack, and Lake Speed has moved to second position. As we told you at the opening of the show, this is the oldest super speedway, built back in 1950. They've been racing on this track ever since, and I guess when you're thinking of a super speedway in this day and age, you wouldn't think of building one like this, but it sure does make an interesting race.
It certainly does, and I don't think they'll ever change it. You know, a couple of years ago, they did maybe put in some new walls and made a lot of improvements here after the International Speedway Corporation bought this track, and a lot of people were concerned that maybe they were going to change that racetrack. They said never. They'll just leave it like it is, because too much tradition, too much action here.
No need to change a successful operation, and this indeed is one here at Darlington International Raceway. Third place, Jeff Bodine. Fourth place, Rusty Wallace. We'll be back with more of our live coverage from the Trans-South 500 here at Darlington. Back at Darlington International Raceway in South Carolina. In a couple of more weeks, our next Winston Cup telecast will come from Bristol International Raceway, the Valleydale 500. And of course, that racetrack also a very challenging one for these drivers, as it is only a half mile in length and some very steep banking on the turn. Saturday, April 9th at 3:30 Eastern Time, the Budweiser Grand National 200, and then the Valleydale 500 Winston Cup race Sunday, April the 10th at 1 o'clock Eastern Time.
Late Speed has moved right up on the back bumper of Mark Martin. He is really putting the pressure on, and just behind them, Rusty Wallace is trying to move around Jeff Bodine. So two good battles going on for first and third.
That's an example of how the track changes. The two cars that looked like they were the quickest now are falling back a little bit, and cars that looked like they may have been top five but not much better are moving up. So the track changes. Maybe it comes to you, maybe it goes away from you. It's something that the crews are always gambling with.
And Lake Speed is trying to find the opportunity to pass Mark Martin for the lead. He may have it here. They're side by side in turn number two. That's Lake Speed on the bottom and Mark Martin up top. Ooh, did they touch coming out of the second corner?
Got awfully close.
Down the back stretch into turn number three. Lake Speed is going to have the lead.
Boy, that's bad news for Dale Earnhardt. He's not far from getting down two laps again if Lake Speed can gain on Earnhardt like he's done the other drivers.
Look at these top four closing in on each other. It's really becoming a great race now as Speed, Martin, Bodine, and Wallace are right there together on the racetrack. Dick Bergman.
A lot of mechanical conversation going on in Mark Martin's pit area right now, guys. The problem, the car is simply too tight. Now, Darlington has a reputation for being a racetrack that tightens up a car, makes it push, understeer as the event goes on. That is the problem Mark Martin suffers from now. It is not, however, a terminal problem. It can be adjusted either with tire stagger on the next pit stop or with a spring change on the next pit stop. They're certainly going to do something to try to square away Mark Martin's car. He'll go faster after the next pit stop if they make the right guess.
This has been one of the longest periods that we have run under green, and I think maybe we're seeing the result of that on the racetrack.
I think that is true, that as the tires heat up, it changes the handling characteristics of the automobile. As Gary pointed out a little bit earlier, the racetrack itself changes, and it changes more, Gary, during a long green flag run than it does as we see them run a while under caution and then...
Well, you're right, Ned. You know, one of the key things, besides the tires going away and the track changing, the fuel load changes. There's a lot of weight in the back of the car, the trunk area, when you put 22 gallons of fuel in there. As that fuel starts going away, it affects the handling. It usually takes a car that is loose and helps him, make him a little tighter. I could see Rusty Wallace was more on the loose side earlier than he is now, so that fuel going away, the weight of that fuel has helped Rusty Wallace.
And Dr. Jerry Punch has a report from the pits.
We are standing in the Lake Speed pit with crew chief Darrell Bryan. And Darrell, you talk about chasing the racetrack with a chassis setup. You told me the track is coming to you guys. What's that mean?
Well, we're kind of set up for a slick racetrack all week, and now the track's beginning to come to us some, so I think we'll be in pretty good shape the rest of the day.
Well, the track had been awfully tight early on. The car was tight for Lake Speed. Now the track is getting a little bit slippery. They're moving their way to the front. This is the same car that Speed finished second in at Rockingham a few weeks ago here on ESPN. Gentlemen?
Well, Lake Speed has had some awfully good runs at this racetrack in the past. A few years ago when he was driving for Hoss Ellington, he was running in second place. He developed an oil leak, but he was bearing down on the leader at that time. Surprised a lot of people. They did not have that much experience on the racetrack or on the Western Cup circuit, I should have said, at that time, but was very impressive. And every time he's been here with a good car under him, he has run this track very well.
And he also has had some good performances earlier this year, a sixth at Richmond, a second at Rockingham. We talked to him earlier about, do you set the car up for one corner over another?
I look at the track as overall, and it's just a compromise. I have to try to get good at both ends, and I try not to give up in either one. I want to be real good at both ends of the racetrack. And when I get the car with that feel that I'm hunting for, each time I'll be tough at both ends of the racetrack. I don't have to give up either one.
Boy, that's quite a tall order to get the car right at both ends.
And here we have a battle for second as Mark Martin and now Rusty Wallace are right behind, Wallace right behind Mark Martin. Bobby Hillen Jr. comes in for a pit stop. You can see he has been one of the ones involved in the two earlier crashes that we had, some body damage on that machine.
In fact, he was involved in the very first accident that took Richard Petty out of the race. Bobby just made a pit stop about 10 laps ago, so he was running one lap down at that particular time, but now he's going to be at least three laps down after making two green flag pit stops.
And Neil Bonnet, another one of those involved in the early crashes. There he is on the inside of the race pack track being passed by the leaders.
Neil, tough break for Neil. He's had such a strong start this season to be involved in that early wreck.
Well, let's run down the 12 cars that are on the lead in that lap now as we watch Rusty Wallace. It's Lake Speed, Mark Martin, Rusty Wallace, Jeff Bodine, Bill Elliott is in fifth, Davey Allison sixth, Sterling Marlin is seventh. In eighth position is Alan Kulwicki. Ninth is Bobby Allison. Tenth is Phil Parsons. 11th is Ricky Rudd. And in 12th position is Buddy Baker in the number 88 car.
Earnhardt hanging on for his life at the moment. There's Mark Martin and Rusty Wallace racing. But slowly but surely, Lake Speed is gaining on Earnhardt.
So Lake Speed is looking good and also looking for his very first Winston Cup win, his best career finish, second on two different occasions. Not quite halfway in the Trans-South 500, lead held by Lake Speed there in the car number 83. In second position is Mark Martin, and third is Rusty Wallace. Now, our race strategy advisor, that's a little computer that we have employed to help us through our Winston Cup races this year. It indicates, as far as next pit stops are concerned, that we should be seeing the cars come in for their next round of pit stops in about eight or so more laps.
You know, figuring out the fuel mileage in these races is loose at best, because it changes, you know, how long the driver's on the gas, the traffic, how quick his lap to run. It's really complicated to try and pinpoint that fuel mileage. What we've done, and a lot of teams have done recently, is gone to computers to try and calculate what the mileage is. Here's a guy, he hasn't got the computer yet. He's still doing it
the hard way.
Doing it the old way. But you can try and calculate based on the lap time how quick the car went around and what his mileage was. It takes a few stops to really get that down, and then the track changes again, and it's still an estimate at best.
They should have pit stops coming up before too long, maybe another six or eight laps, and it'd be green flag pit stops. And so far, the leaders have not had to stop during the green flag runs here today. They've been able to catch cautions to do that.
Well, you know, an interesting thing, the back straightaway pits are good for yellow flag pit stops if you're the leader. You can get in and get out. It's marginal on getting laps, like Dale Jarrett and Rodney Combs earlier got laps. But if you are the leader and you're pitted on the back stretch, you can pit in, get in and get out good on a yellow flag. But if you're the if it's under green, the entrance is so tight going in the back straightaway that you lose time. So Mark Martin pitted on the back stretch, and Lake Speed and the rest of them on the front stretch is going to be interesting.
Here at Lake Speed is moving up on Dale Earnhardt. He was up beside him just a moment ago before they ran in on rookie driver Ken Bouchard. Earnhardt took advantage of the traffic situation and moved out ahead of Lake Speed, but Speed has caught him, wants to put him two laps down again.
Yeah, he's already one lap down, and if the Lake should get by Dale right here, Dale would go two laps down to the leader.
And of course, that was a result of two unscheduled pit stops, four tires, first a right side tire change, then a left side tire change for the fans that might have just joined us late.
For you Dale Earnhardt fans, things have not gone well for him because of the incidents that Ned just mentioned, and that the pole sitter Ken Schrader was involved in an early accident that has eliminated him from a possible win. Now here is Lake Speed trying to put Dale two laps down. He looks to the inside, but decides better of it. And now we'll see what happens as Dale's car slides high on the racetrack and almost puts a Darlington stripe on the car. Speed hitting the accelerator hard, coming out of turn number two down the back stretch, and Lake Speed has put another lap on Dale Earnhardt.
His car is really strong. He's getting such good traction off the turn, particularly off turn two where he just passed Dale Earnhardt.
Earnhardt's pitting. Earnhardt is making another pit stop. There he is, entering on pit road.
That's a smart move to pit as soon as you lose that lap.
Here's Dick Berggren.
Let Ned take into pit road. When he came in here, the front wheels were absolutely locked up. This is almost certainly going to be a two-tire change rather than a four-tire change. They've captured the tires. Right side tire's done. Crew chief Kurt Schumadine does the right side. Earnhardt is away. Boy, I hope his day improves. He's got to if he's going to win this thing.
Now let's see where he comes out in relationship to the leader. The leader goes by on these three laps down. If the leader's behind him, we'll see where he ends up.
Green flag pit stops coming up. You see Alan Kulwicki in the pits now. Greg Sachs just went by coasting a moment ago. I believe Greg ran out of gas. At least he's pitting on the backstretch and coasting around to that area. And Alan Kowicki gets his service now as we see, shift the gears as he heads out of the pits. You'll be watching the traffic coming down the front straightaway as he goes back on to the racetrack, trying to get his speed back up as quickly as possible.
Dale Earnhardt did get out ahead of Lake Speed, so he's not three laps down.
Yeah, heck of a pit stop. It's so close here at Darlington. If you have one little slip in the pits, you're going to end up losing that another lap. So Earnhardt is still two down.
Rusty Wallace is coming in for a pit stop. Here comes Rusty. He's running up at the top five, and Dick Bergwin is right there to call this pit stop.
They're ready for Rusty Wallace. A little tiny dig on the right front of this car, and that's it. Rusty jazzing the engine. He doesn't want to stall it. He says, no thanks to a drink of water. Engine does not sound particularly good as he sits here at the pit. Sounds a little ragged. Right side tire change. Certainly not the fastest tire change we've seen today. And there he goes.
Kodiak Pontiac getting back up to speed as Rusty Wallace rejoins the fray.
It'll be interesting now. Earnhardt's got the fresh tires. Lake Speed's out there with worn tires. Earnhardt's pulling away a little bit.
Now Mark Martin is heading into the pits on the backstretch, the car number six. This would be a scheduled pit stop for Mark Martin as he goes into the pits on the back.
You can see how slow, well, he has to enter the pits real slow because of the narrow entrance to pit road. He's going to lose some time.
Here comes the leader, Lake Speed, as we watch Mark Martin enter his pits on the backstretch. Second place, Mark Martin. Here comes the leader, Lake Speed, in for service.
Okay, now Lake Speed, the leader, pits. We'll see where he comes out in relationship to Dale Earnhardt. Earnhardt was out there for several laps on fresh tires. Plus, he had a good pit stop. If Lake Speed's pit stop is a little off, Earnhardt's going to be back to the two-lap down position.
Let's see how the work on Speed's pit stop goes. Looks like it could be a very quick pit stop. The gas is the last to go in. The tires are changed on the right side. Now the tank is full, and there goes Lake Speed back in the race. Jeff Bodine remains on pit road. There goes Bodine.
Bobby Allison pitting also as Bodine goes out of the pit. These are green flag scheduled pit stops. Bill Elliott comes into the pits up a little further up pit road as Jeff Bodine gets back in the action.
Bodine moving onto the racetrack right ahead of Jimmy Horton. Here's the Bill Elliott crew going to work on that car and removing and changing the tires on the right side. Second can of gas being put in.
You can see the gas man waiting for the jack man waiting for the car to be full of gas before he lets the jack down. That's the signal to go.
There's Davey Allison in for a routine stop.
Same thing. The jack man's watching the gas man. Watching go.
This momentarily should have put Sterling Marlin into the lead, but he's coming down pit road right now in the Piedmont Airlines car along with Brett Bodine and Neil Bonney.
There is Brett pulling into his pit area right ahead of Ken Schrader, who moves back out onto the racetrack. But of course, that Ken Schrader car does not look very much like a race car, in fact, but Ken out there trying to get some valuable Winston Cup points. 194 laps are completed. The Napa mid-race recap. Lake Speed at the halfway point was the leader. He had led 14 of the 184 circuits. The average speed of the race, 125.520. And Lake had pitted on laps 33, 63, and 123. We had five caution periods for a total of 29 laps in the first half of the race. Seven leaders and eight lead changes. 41 cars started, 33 remain, and 12 were running on the lead lap. Out of the race, Kyle Petty, who blew an engine early. Richard Petty, who crashed right behind his son. Dave Marcus and Harry Gant also out. Also dropping out of competition, Morgan Shepherd, Brad Knopfsinger, Benny Parsons, Rodney Combs, and Darrell Waltrip. So the race continues under green, and being shown as a leader right now is Sterling Marlin, but remember, at the moment, he has not made a scheduled pit stop. ESPN Speed World at Darlington International Raceway for the Trans-South 500. And since we left you, Sterling Marlin had the lead, he put it. But Buddy Baker was in the lead momentarily. He has pitted. Phil Parsons was in the lead momentarily. He has pitted. And that gives the lead back to Lake Speed in car number 83. And Rusty Wallace is running in second position. Well, we've talked all year long, really, about the tire war that has been now raging in Winston Cup since the season began. Of course, this tire war really started in Busch Grand National Racing. But now it is a real war between Hoosier and Goodyear here in Winston Cup Racing. Here's Larry.
Hoosier Tire, the newest name on the big league circuit. Amazingly, they won the second Winston Cup race they ever entered. It's a David versus Goliath story, but David has some advantages, too.
Akron, the worldwide headquarters for Goodyear. Around the globe, more than 100 total plants, all reproduced in their impressive model room, and over 125,000 employees, $11 billion in sales. Rural Lakeville, Indiana. Town population, maybe more than 1,000. Hoosier is the Newton family, which lives on the grounds. So private they choose to not discuss tires produced, company worth, or even number of employees. A guess, less than 500.
This is the Hoosier complex at Darlington. The folks in Akron have noticed they're growing a lot more than basketball talent in Hoosierland. And while Goodyear is a worldwide operation, the entire world of Hoosier, when not at the racetrack, is a couple of plants, one administration building, and a small annex.
I think that the short track part of it, we kind of thought we could win pretty quick with that. We had done well last year with Busch Grand National, and we felt we were capable of doing it. Just a matter of getting some good cars.
Being an employee for the past several years and an ex-officio member of the family, maybe you're the best one to ask, how has Hoosier been so successful? What's the secret?
I don't think that you'll find anybody that works any harder at it than the Newtons. They put a lot of hard, long hours into it way back before any word even got out that Hoosier Tire was going Winston Cup racing. Bob Newton is the one guy that I admire. He lives with a stopwatch. Constantly. I mean, he has always got a stopwatch, and that stopwatch tells you a lot. And he could see that the other brands of tires, they have a tendency, they go fast in the beginning, and then they start to slow down towards the end. And then he's thinking, well, if I can build that tire, so the longer I run it, the better it's going to be. I'm going to be there in the end, and that's when I want to be there. When the checkered sheet drops, I want to be there in the end. So I think that's part of the reason of why our success is in Winston Cup racing.
Both stressed that safety is their first priority. But when Goodyear introduced new technology at Indy last year, radials, a compatibility problem with the new March chassis resulted in several crashes. Now, they're not radials, but some drivers experienced control problems with cold Hoosiers at the start of the recent Richmond race. But others said that once they got going, the Hoosiers, at least at Richmond, lasted longer and were better tires. The Goodyear Hoosier tire battle has really heated up and provided some very good competition both on and off the track. Now, Hoosier tires have won two Busch Grand National races already this year, and they've won two of four, or half, of the Winston Cup races so far this season. And here at Darlington this weekend, well, they look pretty strong also.
Well, indeed, the Hoosiers do look strong, and here is a perfect example of the tire war going on, because we have Hoosier against Goodyear here, as Lake Speed is on the Hoosiers and Rusty Wallace on the Goodyears, and Rusty is really making a race out of it.
Boy, he sure is. He taught Lake Speed from quite a ways back. You remember, Rusty was back there racing with Bill Elliott for fifth place, about 10 seconds behind the leader, so he's been steadily moving up. At the same time, Earnhardt is still only one lap down, about 3 seconds ahead of this group.
Now, one thing, Gary, they only changed the right side tires during that green flag pit stop. It might be that the Goodyear worked better with two tires on as opposed to a complete four-tire change. And we'll also make note of the fact that Sterling Marlin has just made an unscheduled pit stop for left-side tire change.
And he was running in sixth position. Let's go to Jerry Punch.
Well, as we said, the standard bearer for Hoosier is Lake Speed. And we are here in the Hoosier Tire mounting compound area. This is an area sort of wedged back behind the fence, somewhat the Bob Uecker maybe portion of the racetrack, in between a couple of semis. These guys can't even see the racetrack, so they have no idea what's going on. But intermittently, Bob Newton, the president of Hoosier, will run back here and tell them, hey, we're leading. Lake Speed's out front. These guys will all begin to smile and mount tires that much quicker. So we're back here in the Hoosier compound. Larry Neuber.
And introducing on your left the latest model from Lakeville, Indiana, this is the Hoosier Tire for Darlington Raceway. And on your right, the latest of the worldwide fruits of the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company. Now, the interesting thing is, look how similar these two tires appear in profile. We did the same demonstration at Rocky Mount, North Carolina a couple weeks ago, and there was a marked difference in the height and the profile of the two tires, but very similar here in Darlington. Now, here is the leaderboard. This is before the last series of pit stops. You can see Hoosier had only Lake Speed and Sterling Marlin in the top 10. The other eight drivers in the top 10, all racing on the Eagles.
And some statistical information regarding Goodyear. As you can see, this battle for the lead is opened up a little bit now. The first Goodyear win in Winston Cup racing was by Jack Smith, March 3rd of 1957. We have a blown engine or some problem with Ricky Rudd in turn number two. Going to the backstretch, Ricky Rudd in the Quaker State Buick has some smoke coming from the rear end of that car, and he's dropped low on the racetrack.
Bob, he had been smoking for several laps out the exhaust pipes. I saw some about 50 laps ago, and then it continued to get worse, and it looks like it's going to take Ricky Rudd out of the race now.
Yeah, right after a pit stop is the most likely time for engine problems to develop. The engine's been running at a steady RPM or somewhat steady RPM on the racetrack. Then the driver gears down to get into the pits, and that's where most likely the damage occurs.
What do you do to prevent that from happening? Just treat the engine a little gently there?
Well, it's hard on the green flag pit stops for the driver, especially to not abuse the engine with the downshift. Try and rely more on the brakes to get into the pits. But if Ricky Rudd has an early pit area, one of the first ones on pit road, I'm sure he had to really gear down heavy to get in and get stopped.
So the crew works on the Ricky Rudd machine. It doesn't look good for the Quaker State Buick operation headed by Kenny Bernstein. 210 laps completed. We'll be back in just a moment. We hope you're enjoying today's live coverage of the Trans-South 500 from Darlington International Raceway in South Carolina, being brought to you by Pontiac Grand Prix, the 1988 Motor Trend Car of the Year. By Goodyear Eagle Tires. Goodyear, because there really is a difference. By Purolator, the first name in filters for Pure Oil now and Pure Oil later, it's Purolator. And by Briggs & Stratton, proud sponsor of the 1988 U.S. Olympic team. Ricky Rudd continues to sit in the area behind the wall. Troubles on that car. Here's Dick Bergeron.
Well, Ricky, you've had a tough week. Had one blown engine, power steering problems. What's the problem now?
I think we must have burned a piston, probably trying to get too much horsepower out of the engine, ran it too lean, and probably burned a piston. It was either that or broke a valve. We're not really sure just yet.
It's a disappointed team. They had hoped for much better here this weekend at Darlington. So Jeff Bodine is coming in right now. Bodine having a problem. Jerry Punch, you anywhere near it?
All right, let's call this Jeff Bodine pit stop. It certainly isn't a scheduled stop, Gary.
No, definitely not scheduled. They're changing right side tires. Waddell's looking at the left side tires. It appears the right rear, yeah, the right rear tire was low on air. Yeah, apparently a puncture. That it should get him back in contention, but we'll see how much time he loses to the leader on the racetrack.
Well, the leader just went by him, Gary, as he was going out of the pits late speed, who is just right on the back bumper of Dale Earnhardt, trying to put him two laps down once again. So Jeff Bodine has gone a lap down.
Well, here's the Quaker State crew there. We're trying to look at the car to see if it's repairable to get back in the race. They got the air cleaner off. You know, that's a tough job. I feel sorry for the crew chief and the mechanics. It's so hot, everything. You can't really tell what's wrong. You just have to take things apart to look at it and hopefully get back in the race. But, you know, you really want to go home at this point.
All right, now we're ready for a report from Jerry Punch.
Back a few years ago when there were gas lines at the service station. Well, take a look here. There are gas lines every Sunday here at a NASCAR race. These wagons line up one by one. There's a race after a routine pit stop to come to the Unocal pumps. They are allowed to fill up two cans. And the crew member here watching these gallon by gallon going in, each can will hold exactly 11 gallons of gasoline. Now, some of the guys can make some adjustments in the cans. It may hold a little bit more, but if NASCAR catches you, it can be awfully serious. 11 gallons of gas here in the gas line on pit road.
Well, Gary, you want to comment on a car holding 22 gallons, or are there instances in which a car holds 22.6, 7, or 8?
Well, you know, NASCAR has its rules, and it's the crew chiefs and the teams' job to try and make the most of that. Yeah. So if they say if one, you know, one man's 22 gallons might not be the same as someone else.
We saw on the screen there as Rusty Wallace moved around Dale Earnhardt. Late speed had already passed him. Now Earnhardt is two laps down, but Earnhardt moved to the inside of the racetrack, let Rusty Wallace go, did not hold him up, didn't race with him for a moment. Very courteous move by Earnhardt. Now he fought hard trying to keep late speed from getting around him, but once the leader goes around him, no, there's no point in him holding off the second place car.
Right here, Earnhardt just went back down to where he was before that round of pit stops. He had gained a good 30 laps. Hopefully another caution come out and give him a break. Be only one lap down.
Well, here's a look at some lap leaders that we've had. Schrader, Jeff Bodine, Davey Allison, Darrell Waltrip, and Mark Martin have all led this race. So has Buddy Baker, Lake Speed, who is the current leader, Bill Elliott, Bill Parsons, and Sterling Marlin. And Jerry Punch is standing by in the pits.
Well, Jeff Bodine's unscheduled pit stop was indeed a situation where they had to come down pit road, had no choice. Take a look why. This is the right rear tire on Bodine's car. You see where it's been written cut on the tire. There's a slice in the rubber all the way down the tire. This tire was going down. You see it's already beginning to deflate somewhat. Another lap or two and Bodine would have been in the wall. He had to pit. Certainly he had to pit. He lost some valuable time.
That's an unusual cut on a tire. Normally, you see just more or less a pinhole in a tire, Gary, but that was a slit of a sort.
Well, that looks like a debris-type cut. Not long after a green flag pit stop, he most likely picked it up leaving the pits. He changed right-side tires and left the pit area. One of the things we can watch later in the race is the line the drivers take from the time they leave pit road to they get on the racetrack. Under green flag conditions, there's a lot of debris that gathers kind of right at the edge of the apron, but not to the grass area. So if the driver cuts across that area, he takes a big chance on cutting a tire.
That's why a lot of times we see cars, when they come out of the pits, will go immediately or as quickly as they can into the racing groove.
Earlier today, we saw Earnhardt give us two examples. One, he stayed on against the grass all the way to the back straightaway. Second time, he pulled right up into the groove, right across all the debris. He was taking more of a chance then, but he had more, you know, he didn't have as much to lose.
By the way, Jeff Bodine's unscheduled pit stop dropped him from third, a lap down, to eighth position.
Also running the lap down is Buddy Baker in car number 88, Bill Parsons in number 55, and Sterling Marlin with his unscheduled pit stop for left side tires also went a lap down. Sterling now running in the 11th position.
We were talking about the tire situation, and then Ricky Rudd had the problem. I was reciting some Goodyear statistics. Their first win in Winston Cup racing was back in 1957 at Concord, North Carolina. Jack Smith, the winner. Their first Super Speedway win was here at Darlington, September 7th of 1959, when Jim Reed won the race. Goodyear had won 526 consecutive Winston Cup races before Neil Bonnet won at Richmond in February of this year on the Hoosiers. And the last brand of tire to win before Hoosiers, other than Goodyear, Firestone, January 10, 1971, at Riverside, California. Lake Speed in the Wins Kmart Oldsmobile leads Rusty Wallace is second, followed by the number three position, number nine, Bill Elliott. Then Mark Martin is in fourth, and Alan Kowicki runs in fifth position with 225 out of 367 laps completed. We'll be back in just a moment, live from Darlington, South Carolina. Speed World from Darlington International Raceway in the Trans-South 500 on this beautiful Sunday afternoon. And there's your leader, Lake Speed. In second is Rusty Wallace, and third is Bill Elliott. At the very beginning of the program, we talked about the drivers who were seeking a first win desperately. And Lake Speed is one of those who has never won a Winston Cup race, yet he has looked so good on so many racetracks, including here in Darlington, but things have just been never been able to go exactly right for a win.
He certainly looks like today that he's in the best position he's been in a long, long time, although he did lead the race at Richmond earlier this year. He also led at Rockingham, looked very strong, but of course did not come out the victor, but things are certainly working in his direction right now.
And Rusty Wallace, who's running in second position, is another one of those who would very much like to have a win this year, and he would like to have a win on a super speedway because he has won four Winston Cup races, two on road courses, two on the short tracks. He would love to register a super speedway victory.
Well, Rusty is, he's one of my favorite drivers. He drives a lot like Dale Earnhardt, flat out. He wants to win. You see him on the short tracks and the road courses where he grew up. He feels a lot more at home on the short track, but he is putting on a heck of a driving show today. He's moved his car up steadily all day long.
And in third position is Bill Elliott. There is Davey Allison as he is battling with Mark Martin out there on the racetrack.
Martin was running in the fifth position, so evidently Allison had just moved around him for that position.
And we'll take a look at the replay, and you can see how strong Davey was in the pass.
He came up, moved right around him on the outside very easily. It looked like Mark just pulled down and let him go.
And earlier, this is how Alan Kowicki disposed of Mark.
Well, he comes up and then looks to the inside and finally decides that's the place to make his move. Mark Martin's car is definitely not running like it was earlier when we saw him leading the race.
Yeah, he's gone from the leader to the next car to be lapped. If the leader could catch him, it's about a half a lap back. Mark Martin, the next car to go a lap down.
That is right. He is in sixth position and there are six cars on the lead lap. Darrell Waltrip, as we watch the action on the speedway, comes in for another stop, and they apparently have gotten that car all repaired, and Darrell is ready to rejoin the race.
Yeah, he just came out of the garage area and he came back down pit road to get the fuel. That's where the gas was. I'm sure they changed the tires and everything else while he was in the garage area, but he needed a little fuel to go, so he's back out the road. Many laps down, of course.
Now, Jeff Bodine is trying to get his lap back. He lost one with an unscheduled pit stop. He has passed Rusty Wallace. Wallace in second, but Jeff would still have to pass the leader a late speed before being able to get that lap back.
Yes.
Barry Dotson, Rusty Wallace's crew chief, is standing by in the pit area.
Well, Barry, you guys have been running way up in the lead pack all day, but you can't seem to quite close. What do you have to do to get this lead and hang on to it?
Well, the first thing you got to do at this place is stay out of trouble. We're trying to do that. Rusty's doing a great job. Jimmy's got the car set up well, and Harold's got the motor running good. We'll probably make some changes. The car's a four. If you're too tight, then you're too tight in running too. So we got a couple changes in store. You know, we need to be a little better.
Okay, that's the story on Rusty Wallace's car. Pit Central, Larry Newberg, take it away.
Earlier in the show, we were talking about that list of people who has never won a race, a Winston Cup race, and among those who have never won a race, obviously, Lake Speed is the man who's doing the best. Now, standing by with me is J.D. McDuffie, and I know that a lot of you like to follow Winston Cup racing. Want an update on J.D.'s condition? Seriously burned this February down in Daytona. J.D., how about the condition? How do you feel?
We're feeling pretty good now. My hand's still mighty tender. I don't know, it'll be a month or so before I'll be back, probably. I'd like to thank all the fans that sent me mail and everything. I really appreciate it. Say hello to my wife back home.
J.D., all those years of struggling as an independent driver, sometimes it's hard to kind of pull all the money together on top of the dining room table and come up with enough cash and go to the next race. Ever any thoughts about stopping this, maybe becoming a car owner like Richard Childress has done?
Well, not quite yet. I still enjoy driving. I'm going to go a couple more years there. And a lot of good people.
Bodine is crashing.
I think I'll have some better help when I do come back.
J.D., we've got a crash out on the racetrack. Jeff Bodine is involved. You can see a multi-car accident. There are three or four cars involved.
Oh, yeah. Buddy Arrington hit the wall pretty hard. Jeff Bodine started it. He scraped the fourth turn wall and began to spin, and then cars behind him were also involved. Is that Dale Earnhardt?
Yeah, Dale Earnhardt involved. Bill Elliott squeezed through. I don't know how he made it.
Earnhardt is getting his car.
And he's coming back out in front of some other cars that are racing down towards the start-finish line, including Lake Speed, but they miss him as he comes down the front straightaway.
Boy, what a deal that was. Earnhardt, nowhere to go. Jeff Bodine up against the wall. Everybody had to let off the gas. Somebody hit Earnhardt from behind, it appeared to me.
Buddy hit the wall pretty hard, I'll tell you. It was almost a head-on collision. You can see the movement in the cockpit, though, so Buddy, we hope, is not injured. Yellow coming out on lap number 239. The front end of that car is written off.
Boy, tough break for Buddy Arrington. You know, he's a lot like that J.D. McDuffie that was just being interviewed. I'm a big fan of these guys. I know how hard it is when you have 15 guys on your crew. These guys do it on a shoestring.
The leader has come in for a pit stop, or is making his way toward the pit area for a stop, and so is Rusty Wallace and just about all of those who are in the lead lap. There's Lake stopping the Oldsmobile and the crew going to work on it. Will this be a two or a four tire change, I think?
Four tires, definitely. Jeff Bodine's crew is going to have to do some cosmetic work also on the car. It looked like the right side tires were rubbing. You can see Lake Speed's jack man let the jack down. He's running around to the left side to get the left side changed. Rusty Wallace is lined up to get out. He's ready for a jump. His crew is a little behind, though. They're just now jacking up the left side. Lake Speed's up, already up and ready to go.
Bobby Allison comes out in the number 12 machine. Lake Speed, good stop for him. Here he is pulling away. And now Rusty Wallace begins to move off pit road.
And here comes Elliott. Bodine. They got Bodine's car fixed quick. They may have to come back in again. We'll have to watch Bodine.
He did have some sheet metal damage on the right side as he got it into the wall.
boy, that traffic gets so heavy. And look at it. The tires, they have to steer around crew members, other cars. They have to look in their mirror to see if anybody's coming from behind. It's very hectic.
There is the rescue squad at the Buddy Arrington car. Panhill Sweatshirt Company sponsoring that machine.
You know, you gotta really pull for Buddy Arrington, J.D. McDuffie, those kind of guys. They do it. So it's, I know how hard it is when you have 20 people on your team. Those guys just work on the car. They can get in it and they drive it. They, you know, when there's a wreck like this, they got to take it home and fix it themselves. I'm a big fan of those guys because I think they're definitely the hardest workers in the sport.
There you can see Buddy is on the stretcher, but he doesn't look to be in all that bad a shape. They will take him into the infield care center to be checked over. So Buddy Arrington crashing here at about lap 237, bringing out our sixth caution period of the day. You can see the medical personnel going into the ambulance with him, and we'll have a report on Buddy Arrington's condition in just a moment. But again, it didn't seem all that serious. Well, you can see that the car has been severely damaged, and we have had a lot of damaged cars so far in this Trans-South 500, which is forcing crew members and owners to go to the parts store to find exactly what they need. Here is an ESPN Track Fact. Quick Facts are brought to you by Quaker State Motor Oil. The big Q stands for quality, always has, always will.
How many of you folks have watched Home Shopping Club? Well, is anything you want to buy there on television? Well, here at the racetrack, anything you want to buy right here at the parts truck. Let's take a look. Well, we got goggles to start with. We got window netting. We got restrictor plates. This is the one that's legal right here. 1-inch plate, Daytona Talladega, makes you go about 185 miles an hour. But this big guy right here will put you over 200 miles an hour. It's illegal, but it has been used, and it's on sale right here. Well, how about parts? Take a look at the catalog. The front few pages of this catalog show what's legal. You don't want those guys. You want to go to the back three or four pages. That's where everybody buys from. Those ones aren't legal, but they go awfully quick. What else do we have here? Collar. Collar to put underneath the helmet. Your head won't flop around on Sunday. Makes it very comfortable during the race. On Monday, you go home, take the collar, stick it in your mother-in-law's mouth, keeps her quiet all week, and you're happy too. What else do we have here? Bell helmets for sale. A nice, soft, padded seat. These things here are excellent. They actually are on the side of the seat to keep you from sliding around in the car, but some car owners have been able to use these things and put them on either side of their driver's heads as blinders. The drivers won't get scared in traffic. Some guys have been accused of using these for years. They can't see a thing in traffic. Well, what else do we have? All kinds of things. Anything you want to buy here. Covers, transmissions, all kinds of parts. A virtual hodgepodge of parts on sale right here at the garage area. Come by and see me.
Now, Gary, in your many times of going to the parts store, did you ever get some of those blinders or the neck collar to keep your mother-in-law quiet?
I've thought about getting blinders like that, but that's a pretty accurate example of what a parts store looks like here at the racetrack. You spend a lot of time there.
The Trans-South 500 at Darlington International Speedway is 242 laps gone, and we're under caution for the sixth time. The Trans-South 500 because of an accident coming out of turn number four that was triggered by Jeff Bodine, and we'll take a replay of it and see if we can determine exactly what happened.
Bodine's car got very high as he came off of turn four and scraped the wall, and behind him there's Buddy Arrington hitting the wall. Dale Earnhardt, of course, right behind Arrington. He got into it. A lot of cars coming down through there. Neil Bonnett down on the inside. The second time today that Neil Bonnett has been involved in one of these straightaway skirmishes.
Well, Buddy Arrington took the hardest shot as he hit the inside wall nearly head-on. He's been taken to the care center. Here's a report from Dick Bergren.
Well, Bob, they just brought him in here on a stretcher, but as they brought Arrington in, his eyes were open, and he was alert, and he waved at all those of us who had assembled here concerned about his condition. Jerry Punch, what's going on where you are?
Well, Neil Bonnett is still sitting in the car. They're trying to get some work done on the car here, and Neil Bonnett, they're trying to... He's been involved in accidents, numerous accidents today, and Neil... It's not been your day today, partner.
Well, I tell you, from the start, somebody rammed us in the rear and we got in that big mess. And then coming off this corner, I guess the five-car wreck, Dale lifted, I ran right in the back of it.
Well, you can hear them beating and banging. They're trying to get this Babylon Pontiac back on the racetrack.
All right, thank you, Jerry and Dick. And we'll be back to continue our coverage of the Trans-South 500 right after these messages. They were thinking about going green, but were still under caution. Sterling Marlin has made up a lap that he lost, and Mark Martin has lost a lap because he pitted on the backstretch.
Yes, he did. He apparently went in too early, or whatever the situation was. Mark Martin did lose a lap back there, and we got some cars that are coming down pit road here again before the green reflies.
Now, Gary, what's the strategy here?
Well, they're looking to the end of the race. I'd have to figure it out on a calculator, but if they can make it with one more stop to the end, it's a smart move to stop now. I'm sure Ernie Elliott and his crew have thought about that. Although they are changing four tires on Elliott's car, possibly he had a vibration, something like that.
And he, too, could have run over some debris on the racetrack, taking no chances. They've come in and changed those tires. We are really in a position now that there are only six cars on the lead lap. So making a pit stop and having to go back in the field at this point of the race is not nearly as costly to you as it would have been earlier when you would have had gone behind 25 or 30 cars that might have been in the lead lap. Now they're on behind five or six.
Gary, do you look in the record books and study previous races to determine possibly when you do make a stop?
You know, it's interesting, Bob. We've done that over the years with the history of the last 10 years. We did it on a computer. What we did was we've documented all the caution flags from start to finish of every race and when they were most likely to occur. Darlington seemed to be the track that had the most clear pattern over all the years. It seemed like sometimes there would be a caution flag, a lot of cautions early, just like today. Then later on in the race, not many. Then a long green spell to the end. So it's something you got to really watch.
All right, we're still under caution, so we're going to take another break and be right back for racing action here at the Trans South 500. We'll be right back.
To making great wheels look their best, Eagle One doesn't miss a beat. Eagle One, a complete line of wheel and body care products for those who love cars as much as we do.
Just how good are genuine GM parts? Good enough for Dale Earnhardt, three-time Winston Cup driving champion. And the same kind of quality that goes into the GM parts for his car goes into the GM parts for your car. So get the goods under your hood. Genuine GM parts. From your General Motors dealer.
When Radio Shack put their $849 computer on sale for only $599, I just had to have it because it runs the same IBM PC software I use at the office. I got this complete system, including color monitor, for only $899. And it came with seven programs in one, like word processing, budgeting. My wife uses it to run her catering business.
Homework, Dad.
They use it so much, I'm thinking of getting my own.
Save $250 on a Tandy 1000SX. Only $599 with software. Complete system, only $899 at Radio Shack.
It's every cowboy's worst nightmare. And when the worst is over, you head for the beer that goes down smooth as a mountain stream. Bush.
Does anybody want to start the campfire?
Head for the mountains of Bush Beer.
Just went back to green, and we've had another spin up in turn number three involving Eddie Bierschwin and I believe Ken Bouchard, the other car involved, but all cars are moving. The yellow does, however, come out once again.
And it's going to be a break for Jeff Bodine. He had moved around leader Lake Speed to get back in the lead lap. So, like Sterling Marlin a moment ago, Jeff Bodine has got back in the lead lap.
The green had just come out. Jeff Bodine had gotten a jump on Lake Speed and had passed Lake, and then the caution comes out again, so Jeff is going to get the lap back. He'll be able to encircle the entire racetrack now.
Yeah, now what Jeff should do is stay on the track, get caught up to the pack, and then come in for a pit stop. Since he's last anyway, four tires and gas right now would be a good move.
All right, lap 252. Gary, you had done some calculating, and you had determined that those guys who pitted just a couple of laps ago, namely Bill Elliott and Davey Allison, had themselves been been calculated and probably now can go the rest of the race.
Yeah, really, I'm surprised Lake Speed didn't come in that caution. He's had two opportunities now to pit and get some gas. It would allow him to make only one more pit stop to the end of the race. Bill Elliott obviously did it. Davey Allison did it. They can make it to the end with one stop, where these other guys will probably have to make two stops.
Yeah,
Jeff Bodine coming from last now. He's the last car on the lead lap. Here we go with Dick for the pit stop.
Well, Gary, you're right on the button. Just about the time when you said these guys ought to make a pit stop for four tires and gas, they all scurried around the pits, came up with the four tires, got the gas cans ready, and here they are, going to do their thing. They're also taping over the windshield to try to prevent some of the glare from bothering. But now the jack band just fell down coming around the corner. Even pit road is slippery. Bodine now helping himself by taping a little bit of the windshield over. Right side tires are on, left side tires going on. This will put Bodine in good shape as he takes off out of the pit area with a full load of fuel and four good tires.
So Bodine now moves back out, and here is a replay of the incident up in turns 3 and 4.
Andy Beersball down on the inside, or trying to go on the inside, follow Dale Earnhardt through there of Kenny Bouchard, the leading rookie driver, and they tangle, and around they go, and then the caution comes out.
Nobody hurt real bad, though, and the caution does come out. However, Sterling Marlin is on pit road as everybody else stays out now, waiting for resumption of this race here in South Carolina.
When you say radio, most folks in these parts think of WHKP now in our 42nd year. On the air full-time, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, using state-of-the-art facilities. WHKP-EZ, your full-service station with a career staff of 20 local people whose roots run deep in Henderson County soil. Most of them own their homes here, and their talents are augmented by both the ABC radio and the Mutual Networks for world news coverage, along with personalities such as Paul Harvey and Larry King. Music. WHKP's playlist includes over 250 artists and more than 1,000 all-time easy hit songs, including the new songs that will someday become easy hits. Weather? We don't use gimmicky names for our weather broadcasts. We just tell it like it is. After all, we wrote the book. Sports? Local, state, and national. WHKP covers it all. No wonder WHKP-EZ is everyone's home and traveling companion. Now in our 42nd year, AM 1450, Cable TV, Channel 7.
This is where champions begin.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Mike Tyson, Terrence Ali, Ray Boom Boom Mancini. Superstars who forge steel nerves and iron punches on Budweiser's top-ranked boxing. Former lightweight champion Livingstone Bramble battles the hard-hitting Edwin Jarrett Wednesday night at 9 Eastern, live on ESPN.
The green flag is out again, and Rusty Wallace has taken over the top spot from Lake Speed. Bobby Allison is there leading the contingent down the backstretch, but Bobby is getting a lap back. Rusty Wallace, the leader, now with Lake Speed in second.
Yes, Bobby Allison is hoping for a caution, just like Jeff Bodine got a moment ago, but now Rusty Wallace moves on the inside of him, and he's going to put Bobby a lap down.
Close as they came out of corner number four.
Look at four abreast. Can't they make it into turn one?
Speed squeezes through. He gets in the front again as Bobby Allison and Rusty Wallace run side by side. We're watching from the Xerox Ford of Alan Kulwicki. He's the fourth car involved in all of this.
Something's got to give in turn three there, yeah. Bobby let Rusty in front.
Kulwicki is third in the race. Remember, Allison is a lap car right ahead of Alan.
See the sun coming into the windshield going down the front straightaway. It gets worse and worse now as the day goes on. You almost lose all sight of the other traveling.
And we heard that there was some tape being put on the front windshields of the Jeff Bodine car, and there was some earlier of the Davey Allison car. Is that legal?
And Rusty Wallace is off the pace as he heads into turn three. Rusty's slowing down.
Yes.
As we see his Bobby Allison moving on the outside of him, Rusty must have thought he had a tire going down or something, because he's definitely off of the pace.
He's to the inside, and here comes Bill Elliott. And don't forget, Jeff Bodine is back on the lead lap.
Jeff Bodine's right back in it.
Davey Allison is also right there. He's on the lead lap, but Rusty Wallace is going backwards.
You got to really watch it. Elliott, see how sharp the fenders are on Jeff Bodine's car. Elliott has to really watch him as he goes by. That was a little close. Those, a sharp fender like that can really cut your tire.
Now we're beginning to see some real racing activity. Second win for many of these drivers. Bill Elliott and Jeff Bodine are side by side. Watching from behind is Davey Allison. In front of that group is Alan Kulwicki, and leading the race is Lake Speed.
He's gone for the moment, at least. He has really moved out into about a two-second lead. Alan Kulwicki tries to move around to Bobby Allison.
I ask you the question about the tape on the windshield. Are they supposed to do that?
Well, NASCAR frowns on it. That you're supposed to put any tinting or any kind of tape on the windshield from the inside, not from the outside. Several of the teams have been putting tape on the outside. You can see Jeff Bodine right above his vision. They put tape as a sun visor. You almost have to have it here at Darlington.
I was going to say that becomes more of a safety thing than it does anything else.
Yeah, I think NASCAR kind of looks the other way on that.
Here's Davey Allison trying to make a move on Jeff Bodine.
Let's go to Dick Bergeron, who perhaps has an explanation on the Rusty Wallace situation.
Well, Bob, for the Rusty Wallace fans, the news is not good. He has lost a cylinder. He is down to seven. That is something that is almost unfixable. They have even brought the water hose around, indicating that the engine is overheating. He had run well, but today's not going to be it for Rusty.
Well, on this replay, Ned, you can see that everybody was aware that something was going wrong with the car there coming out of the fourth turn.
Yes, and that's why we saw as many cars. They went four wide for just a moment as it came down the front straightaway, but they did sense that something was wrong with Rusty Wallace's car, so they started making their move to try to get around him before they got into turn one.
Davey Allison has moved to third, Bodine fourth, and Bill Elliott fifth. And look who's back there in the group, Dale Earnhardt. After all the bumps and bangs he has taken today, he won't give up. He's still passing cars.
You know, that is Rusty Wallace losing a cylinder. Probably will have a hard time finishing. It's tough on these engines to restart a race, making green flag pit stops and restarting. It's the most critical time on the engine. Rusty Wallace jumped out to the lead on that restart and might have overstressed his engine doing that.
And it's possible they could have over-revved it on the start of it. On a restart, a lot of times drivers get anxious and they'll just simply over-rev them. And the biggest thing that could happen there, Gary, is breaking a valve train.
Exactly. The valve train is the weak link, especially RPM-related. If you over-rev the engine above 82, 8300, you're asking for trouble in the valve train. The valve springs probably, in Rusty's case here, he's probably lost one cylinder.
The leader is Lake Speed, and as Ned indicated, he has taken off from the rest of the field, although Alan Kulwicki now begins to close in just a little bit. For a while there, Lake Speed had a tremendous lead, but now Alan Kulwicki of the Xerox Ford, and that's who we're riding with right now, is beginning to close in just a little bit on the leader. Allison, Davey, third, fourth, Elliott, fifth, Bodine, sixth to Sterling Marlin, and the number 27 car of Rusty Wallace is in seventh position. Then a lap down is Bobby Allison, ninth is Phil Parsons, in 10th position is Mark Martin, and 11th is Buddy Baker. Those cars are lapped down. And now the battle is between Jeff Bodine and Sterling Marlin for 5th position. Here's the in car from Dale Jarrett.
Well, Dale's windshield beginning to get pitted quite a bit, and as you can see, as he heads down into turn one, he couldn't see too well. Dale's car's running very strong now. He's trying to move around Jeff Bodine, even though Dale is three laps down.
Yeah, Bodine's car, I don't think, is working as well as it was, too.
No, he took an awful hard hit on the wall there. He was fortunate to get his lap back on that quick caution, one after the other, but I think he may have a little trouble racing for the lead as we go here.
Dale Jarrett's car, and he's right behind Jeff Bodine. Next time around, we'll have 100 laps to go. Next time around will be the completion of the 267th lap. And Rusty Wallace is pulling into the pits and into the garage area, calling it quits for the day. A very tough break for Rusty Wallace. As once again, a super speedway victory eludes him. And the next opportunity he'll have to win a super speedway event will be in Talladega.
Oh, To some, it's routine maintenance. To others, it's an act of love. If you truly appreciate fine machinery, you protect it with Purolator filters.
I heard you got one, Fred. I just had to come over and take a look.
Yeah, wanted one all my life. Great. Look at the way it's put together. Well, no wonder they last.
Mind if I just, you know, sit behind the wheel? Oh, boy, would I like one of these. Can I take it for a spin?
Well, just in the front yard.
Oh, boy.
Nothing runs like a deer.
The Oldsmobile of Lake Speed leads the Trans-South 500, and there you can see that that make of car has never won this race.
Lake Speed looks awful strong. He just seems like he's gaining as the race goes on. That's almost unusual for a car non-winner like Lake Speed to get stronger as the race goes on, but he is obviously picking up momentum.
And the car number 7 of Alan Kowicki is picking up some momentum too, because it looks like he might be gaining a little bit on Lake Speed. Lake jumped out to a good lead after the restart, but now Alan Kowicki began to move in a little bit on him.
And it's interesting to note that the drivers that are running first and second here are non-Winston Cup winners. Neither has ever won a Winston Cup race, so we could have a first-time winner in the next 97 laps or so.
Just a moment ago, while we were on the commercial break, Derek Cope blew the engine in his Purolator Ford number 68, so he is another of those that has had to bite the dust here today.
Yeah, that was a shame. He was running pretty good in that Ford, Derek Cope. He's been putting on a pretty good show the last several races.
Lake Speed is 40 years of age, hailing from Jackson, Mississippi. He goes into this race 14th in the point standings. He has competed in every race this year, and his best finish was a second at Rockingham. He also finished 6th at Richmond. He was running at the end of both of those races. The other two events so far this year, he finished 37th at Daytona, not finishing because of an engine problem, and he lost a cylinder in Atlanta last weekend also. Jerry Punch is with Rusty Wallace.
Well, a heck of a job by this young man, Rusty Wallace, who just climbed out of the Kodiak Pontiac. And Rusty, they're still working on the car. Are you going to be able to get back in?
Well, I don't know, Jerry. We lost a cylinder in the engine, and the guys are going to try to patch it up, so they're running 7 cylinders, and we get back out there for some points.
You're running awfully well out there.
Yeah, the car's running real good. I'm pretty sure I could have won the race. We made a chassis adjustment that very last pit stop, and the car really went to run it down in turn 3 and 4. So too bad this happened, because I think we've had a good shot at it today.
Now, with you out of it, who's the strong horse out there? Who would you pick?
Well, Lake's definitely real strong, but now there's a couple cars that got their laps back up. The 44 car's back up there, the 9 car. But Lake, he's been pretty dominant all day long, and him and I have been able to pretty well run away from the field. So I got to say that Lake's got the best shot at it right now.
Well, we talked about it at the top of the show, a new winner possibly here at Darlington. It could dictate Lake Speed.
Well, Lake is leading, but he is not running away with the show at the moment. As a matter of fact, Alan Kowicki is staying right with him.
He has caught him. Boy. And he's right on his back bumper. Kowicki is definitely running faster than Lake Speed, because he was about 2.5 seconds behind him. Now he's a half a car length behind him.
Well, that's a good shot. Here they go right down the back straightaway into 3. Right up to his bumper.
There used to be a bump right there in turn number 4, Ned, but I guess they sort of eliminated it when they paved the track a couple of years ago.
They did a great deal to eliminate it, Bob. It's still a very sharp turn as you come off of there, and you really have a lot of speed as you're coming off of there, because as you decelerate, as we talked earlier, going into turn 3, and then if your car is working properly, you can just accelerate fully through that turn, and you've really built up a lot of speed until you get there, and that wall comes up in a hurry. But they eliminating a portion of that bump, in fact, most of it has helped them coming off there, and I think has helped them make better racing here at Darlington.
And there once again, Gary, is your point that you wanted to make about the sun and how terrible it is going into turn number 1.
Boy, can you imagine driving at that speed that close to another competitor and going into that sun and not being able to see? I know what it's like on the freeway when the sun's in your eyes. Can you imagine at these speeds?
it's almost as bad as the visibility was when Kyle Petty blew his engine down here in the early going. The visibility is almost that bad.
You're right. The windshield is sandblasted. The sun is reflecting off those pits on the windshield, and it makes it difficult, very difficult to see.
Gary, I think that your eyes somewhat adjust to the conditions as you move along. I remember back in the dirt track days when I was driving race cars, we were running a lot of dirt tracks, and the dirt would build up on the windshield of the car, and you could just hardly see anything. As a matter of fact, after the race, you'd look, how in the world did I see out? Apparently, your eyes adjust to it to some degree.
Yeah, your body's pretty resourceful to get you through these kind of things, but, boy, I tell you, I'm glad it's them, not me.
With just about a car length advantage over Alan Kulwicki. Now they approach some slower traffic, and this is one of the places to watch for a lead change.
H.B. Bailey in car number 36 from Houston, Texas, moves out of the way and gives him plenty of running.
You know, that's one race H.B. always comes to is Darlington. You don't see him for 3 or 4 months, and he always shows up at Darlington.
And he usually makes the field here, too. I mean, yeah. In fact, most every time he comes here, but he had a real bad accident here several years ago, as we see Alan Kulwicki trying to set lake speed up, but he was not able to do it that time.
Yeah, I remember H.B. took a shot like Buddy Arrington took down here coming out of turn number 4 a few years ago, head on into the inside wall.
Yeah, broke the wall, in fact,
yeah,
when he hit
right. So they've disposed with that slower traffic now and have moved into somewhat cleaner air. Well, back in 1961 at this racetrack, very popular chief mechanic played an instrumental role, and that chief mechanic was Smokey Unick. That's the subject for our Winston Cup replay. Winston Cup replays are brought to you by Purolator, the first name in filters. For Pure Oil Now and Pure Oil Later, it's Purolator.
Smokey Unick was one of the all-time great Grand National mechanics. He won 3 Southern 500s. Fireball Roberts drove his cars to 4 wins in the first 8 races at Daytona. There are many stories about Unick and his rule bending, but the end result was Smokey was a winner. He helped many drivers to stardom and won a place for himself in the Hall of Fame.
Who'll be the winner and the winning chief mechanic at this race? Well, we'll tell you in about 80 more laps as we continue our coverage of the Trans-South 500.
To some, it's routine maintenance. To others, it's an act of love. If you truly appreciate fine machinery, you protect it with Purolator filters.
If you're looking for the only sports car in the world that gives you the superior traction of front-wheel drive, a competition suspension, and an unbeatable 770 protection plan, then look no further. It's gotta be the intercooled turbocharged Dodge Daytona Shelby Z.
Now get up to $1,500 cash back on Daytona models in stock.
CarQuest Auto Parts stores salute the professional mechanic. He does a job once, does it right. He makes a promise on service and repairs. He keeps it. He's a professional. He depends on other professionals like CarQuest. We know our parts as well as he knows how to repair cars. And CarQuest sells only the highest quality products, guaranteed by over 2,300 CarQuest stores coast to coast to fit right every time. CarQuest Auto Parts stores, the professionals professionals prefer.
Back at Darlington, where Lake Speed in car number 83 continues to lead the number 7 car of Alan Kulwicki. But still some great racing going on behind these two. There is Jeff Bodine in the number 5 car. Behind him is Phil Parsons. Dale Jarrett is in on this battle also in turn number 3.
And Mark Martin in the car number 6. And there's two sets of drivers running side by side around that turn.
Two abreast racing. There we are inside Dale Jarrett's car. They fall into single file formation. formation now. Dr. Jerry Punch has a report from the pit area.
We're talking about how important it is to get in a race car and be 100%. Now, we talk about stock car therapy. There is no better medicine for a race car driver than getting back on board the stock cars. Take a look at some of the walking wounded over the years. Richard Petty, of course, at Daytona, he did somersaults along the fence, came back a week later and finished third at Richmond. Remember Ricky Rudd's violent crash during the Busch Clash at Daytona? Rudd somersaulting the Bud Moore car? Well, Rudd came back a week later and won at Richmond. How about Bill Elliott here after last week? Spending 2 days in the hospital, his shoulder unable to raise it more than about 15 degrees off the side of his body. He is in a race car here driving now close to 300 laps here at Darlington. So the walking wounded, hey, don't forget Neil Bonnet. What happened to him? His career was almost over. He climbed back in a race car and he felt great. Not only did he feel good, he drove good and won two of the first three races. Sure good medicine here. Stock car therapy, they call it. On track healing in NASCAR.
Ned can relate to stock car therapy because 1965, I believe, was the year, Ned.
Yes, it was. And here at the Darlington Raceway, the biggest win of my career, really. And I won that race with a back brace on. I had a wreck at Greenville, South Carolina on a half-a-mile dirt track back in June and had to wear a back brace for 3 months. Had a cracked vertebrae in the lower part of my back. And after that win here at Darlington, I didn't have any more back problems for a long, long time. Okay.
It's amazing medicine, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
That therapy, yes, sir. You know, I worked with Bobby Allison for 3 years, and I can remember he never was healthy. He had broken fingers, broken toes, broken ribs, broken shoulder one time, and he only missed maybe one or two races that whole time.
Our race summary shows that Lake Speed has led 108 out of 285 laps. The average speed of the race up to 127.804. 8 caution periods, total 41 laps. 11 leaders, 16 lead changes, and 6 cars remain on the lead lap. And there is number 1, Lake Speed, the number 83 car, and number 2, Alan Kowicki in the number 7 car.
You wonder if Kowicki, he caught Lake pretty easily. He made an attempt or two to pass him, but now he just sort of backed off and just sitting there riding. And you wonder if he is just sort of taking it easy now, biding his time, not going to show his complete hand at this point of the race.
77 laps to go, so if somebody is going to do something, it will probably occur within the next 20 or 30 laps or so. But right now, Lake Speed is the leader, and we'll be back with more from Darlington.
Every Ferrari 328 and every Ferrari Testarossa that comes to America comes on Goodyear Eagles. And only on Goodyear Eagles. Why? Because Mr. Ferrari wants it that way. Goodyear Eagles, Ferrari's choice as America's best tires.
Honey, game's gonna start soon.
I think I'll give the lawn a quick cut.
When you're long on grass and short on time, you need a mower with a Briggs & Stratton engine.
Dad, the pre-game show's on!
It'll start quickly and work hard till the job's done.
Sure hope he makes it.
Yes, there he is!
Briggs & Stratton, the power in power equipment. Dodge Shadow ES. When you look at its 60 standard features, its turbocharged engine, its 770 protection plan, when you consider the fact that the Shadow ES is a better value, almost $700 less than the Chevy Cavalier C24, you'll agree, when it comes to outstanding value, it's gotta be a Dodge.
And with $500 cash back, you've now got an even better value.
You give your all to all you do. Don't settle for less from your shampoo. Wash and go, Pert Plus.
Ordinary shampoo can't give you this kind of manageability. You need Pert Plus, with a unique combination of effective shampoo for cleaning, plus conditioner for control, all in one. For great, easy-to-manage hair, it's one of a kind.
Just one shampoo does it all for you. Wash and go.
With shampoo, conditioner in one.
Pert Plus.
back at Darlington, where Lake Speed leads the Trans-South 500. We're on lap 295, and our race strategy advisor indicates that his next pit stop will have on lap number 305. So 10 more to go in Lake Speed. We'll be headed for pit road once again. And now let's go to Pit Central and Larry Newberg.
Thanks, Bob. Well, here is a rundown of the leaders of this race up to this point. You can see that Lake Speed had a very stout afternoon, staying in the top 10. By the way, a profile very similar to what we saw from Neil Bonnett during the Rockingham race. Sterling Marlin right here with the 8, 7, 7, and 8. He, too, has remained very consistent in the top 10. Alan Kowicki, you can see he was languishing back in the 13th and 10th positions earlier in the race. He has gradually moved up. I'll tell you, the profile that most closely matches the winner of the race at Rockingham, Neil Bonnett, is the one that Lake Speed's been turning in. One comment about the crew chiefs of Lake Speed and Alan Kowicki. Darrell Bryant is the crew chief of Lake Speed. He's been around since 1978. He has only won one race himself. That was with Terry Labonte back in 1980. And what about Alan Kowicki? A gentleman by the name of Paul Andrews is listed as his crew chief. Paul has been associated with Alan, but Alan probably comes as close to being a driver crew chief as any driver on the trail. As of yesterday, the budget is so tight for Alan Kowicki. As of yesterday, Saturday, he did not even have a jack man. Friday was here practicing with the truck driver slash mechanic and himself.
And our indication is that Alan Kowicki, when he comes in for his next pit stop, will be loosening up the car. Now, how would they do that, Gary?
Well, they'll probably do it, obviously, with the tires. They're going to change right side tires and gas, I'm sure. Possibly a mechanic may jump in the window and turn one of the wedge bolts. It's unusual to loosen up a car as the race goes, but I think the temperature may be dropping a little bit. They're running through a shadow in turn two. When the track temperature gets colder or cooler from where you were running, the car that may have been neutral will tend to push then, plow the front end. And if, when they say loosen up the car, what they want to do is get the balance back, get the car more neutral driving again.
So, Ned, how will that affect the handling for Alex?
Well, that made it run a little bit faster. Now, one thing, we've talked about how tough this race is on this particular racetrack. If the car is uncomfortable and a little too loose for the first 400 miles, I'll tell you, it can make a miserable long day for you. But you want it a little bit tight so that you're feeling good and you're still there to make that run at the end. And then at the end, you loosen her up a little bit, let her go faster, and so you just battle it for the rest of the way.
There's a battle for fourth position. That is Bill Elliott and Sterling Marlin as we once again go to the pit area.
We're at Alan Kowicki's pits with Paul Andrews, and Paul is one of only three employees Alan has running this operation. And Paul, you're going to pit in about, what, four or five laps, and we understand you may have to adjust the chassis on the car.
Yeah, that's right. We're going to try to loosen it up with the tires that we put on and probably loosen it up a little bit with the jack bolt on the left rear, too.
Can you get around possibly Lake Speed? He caught him pretty easily, but then it didn't pass him.
Well, I think he's more or less just kind of working with his tires a little bit, trying not to burn them out, because we are just about ready for a pit stop here.
Well, this car that Alan Kowicki is driving here, remember, this is the car he settled a pole with at Dover a year or so ago, and it's the car he finished second to Dale Earnhardt with at Pocono last year. It's his best race car.
We've had a change for fourth position as Sterling Marlin has passed Bill Elliott and moved to fourth. And one interesting fact is that Bill Elliott has run this spring race 9 times and has never finished out of the top 10. And he's now in fifth position, so he is threatening to continue that streak.
Bill has run a good steady race. He hasn't been up there battling for the lead much today. Whether that's part of his strategy or whether the car just won't do any better than that, he certainly has driven a good, smart race.
I know, Gary, you've complimented Bill all race long and thought that he could be very, very strong here in the late going.
Well, I've been following Bill Elliott. You know, he's always a threat at Darlington. His record shows that, but he doesn't run in traffic. This is my first real view from up above. I'm always in the pits watching, and you don't see what you see up here, but Bill Elliott runs by himself here at Darlington. When there's traffic around him, he lets them go. And if he gets a chance to pass somebody, he waits until they get a real good open shot. Bill Elliott is very patient. I think he learned a lot from watching David Pearson as he grew up. David Pearson drove much like that.
This completes lap number 304, so we should be seeing some pit stops now in just a lap or so as Lake Speed's pit crew readies, and he may be coming in next lap.
Evidently, they are ready for him to come in, and I suppose they'll change the right side tires and, of course, fill it up with gasoline.
It'll be interesting to see when they leave the pits what drivers take the line straight out to the racetrack and which ones stay against the grass. You gain some time by going straight out the racetrack at the risk of puncturing a tire.
Okay, he is coming into the pits this time around, I believe. Late speed dips down as he comes off of the fourth turn and heads down pit road.
This should be the final pit stop of the race for Lake Speed if we should continue to go green the rest of the way. Speed brings the Oldsmobile in.
His crew chief said they were going to do some tires, change tires, but maybe change some wedge. I don't see anybody yet working on the wedge bolts.
Now, that was Kowicki's crew that was going to do that, Gary. And Kowicki will be coming up here very shortly as Lake Speed gets the service on his car. They are just changing the right side tires. Of course, they fill it up with gasoline. Now, my stopwatch says he made it 16 1/16 seconds.
Here is Kowicki coming out of corner number four. He's in the upper right of your screen, or was there for a moment. And Bobby Hillen Jr. is pulling out of the pit area. There is Kowicki high on the racetrack. Below Alan Kowicki is the car of Bobby Hillen Jr. When he came by in front of us, the right front wheel wasn't moving.
No, it wasn't. It was absolutely not turning, and he's going to get stalled, it looks like, over on the second turn. He might be able to make it back around, but he is, I'm sure, already has blown the right front tire as he went out of the pits. The wheel, as you said, was locked up. It was not turning.
But what causes that is the lug nut gets caught in between the brake rotor and the wheel. All he has to do is back up and it falls out, but he's going to continue on around the track.
And here is Kowicki as we see him bringing the Ford into his pit area for a stop.
Okay, here's the one that they said it may make a chassis adjustment. Yeah, there's a man going in the window now, bumping the camera.
Lake Speed in the upper right. Coming out of corner number four as the jack goes down on the Kowicki car. They're still trying to get the fuel in the car.
Yeah.
Allen was a little late getting out, and Lake Speed now is going to have quite an advantage.
Yes, he is. Lake Speed moving around Dale Earnhardt out on the racetrack. But Kowicki was in the pits about a second and a half longer than Lake Speed was in. They got the tires changed very quickly, but they didn't get the fuel in quite as quickly as Lake Speed's crew did.
And that means that Davey Allison is in the lead because he has not made a stop. And you can see that Dale Earnhardt has been passed once again by Lake. So Davey Allison is the leader. Sterling Marlin is running second, and Bill Elliott third. And there is the leader, Davey Allison. Oh, we have a car spinning, entering the pit area.
Brent Bodine, in car number 15. It looked like that he was out of gas as he slowed coming around turns 3 and 4 and then got down on the inside, but he has spun at the upper end of the pit area. He gets the car riding. Apparently, he's not completely out of gas because he's running. It must be very slippery coming into the pit area up there on the turn 4.
Would that have caused a caution had the car stalled there? I suppose it would have.
Well,
really,
yeah.
Given a break to Allison and Sterling Marlin and Bill Elliott.
Yeah, it sure could have, but since he was able to get it to going again, of course, he was not in any danger of those out on the racetrack, but those that have to enter the pits, and Bill Elliott is coming into the pits right now. He could have been a hazard to them.
One of those contending for the lead is Bill Elliott. Here is Dick Berggren.
And you talk about a sandblasted windshield, this guy's got one. By the way, the problem with Brent Bodine may well have been he is ill in the car. Rusty Wallace just walked down in the direction of his pit with helmet in hand, prepared to relieve an ill-feeling Brent Bodine. Bill Elliott has taken two tires, and he is back. He should not need to return again.
Bill Elliott, one of the walking wounded that Jerry talked about earlier, suffering that shoulder injury last week at Atlanta, and Davey Allison's pit crew now prepares for him to stop. There's Davey entering turn number 3.
Now Davey has taken over the lead as a result of the other drivers making pit stops.
Allison up very high on the racetrack, but is not going to stop this time. It's Alan Kowicki right behind him.
Certainly they would like to run as far as they possibly can. Like to catch a caution, but you know, the cautions don't always come at your convenience.
And you don't want to do what Benny Parsons did last week, and that is stretch it just a little too far. Well, Jerry can tell us perhaps of the fuel situation regarding Davey Allison.
He
They're telling us here in the Allison pits that Allison could actually make it as far as maybe lap 317 or 318. And the question mark is, do they want to gamble? Do they want to stretch it and maybe get a caution flag? And Allison could pit under yellow for four tires. Remember what happened in Atlanta with Benny Parsons when he tried to stretch it that one last lap and he ran out of fuel and it cost him a shot at winning. Well, they are ready here in the Allison pits. They have the tires up on the wall. The gas cans are ready. And they're going to stretch it maybe at least two or three more laps, maybe all the way to 317 or 318.
Well, our indication was that Davey and Bill Elliott stopped on lap 247, so you add 70 to that, and that would allow Davey Allison to complete 317 laps before having to come in. Of course, Bill has already stopped for his last pit stop of the day, but yeah, Davey could go to lap 317. We're in Alan Kulwicki's car once again, looking out from the back glass.
Lake Speed, after this round of pit stops, if there's no cautions, Lake Speed is definitely going to be the one that benefited the most.
And Lake is on Hoosier tires, don't forget. He just passed Dale Earnhardt, Alan Kulwicki did.
Yeah, watch the groove Earnhardt's been running. He's fighting that car every inch of the way, right up to the wall.
I think Dale would have to win my Perseverance Award for the Trans-South 500 today.
Oh, for sure. He's driven his heart out. Of course, that's nothing unusual for Dale Earnhardt because he drives as hard as he'll go every lap it'll go.
Now, we are going to see a Davey Allison pit stop. There you see the crew with the board. Here comes Davey Allison down off the banking, headed for pit road, and Jerry Punch will call this pit stop by Davey Allison.
Tony Price and Robert Yates, the rest of the Haviland crew, waiting for Davey Allison. Their young driver brakes the car in slowly. Remember, those brakes are critical late in the race here. The car comes to a halt, and they go to work on the right side of the car. Two tires on the right side of the car, cleaning that windshield. The windshields have been sandblasted so much, they are so difficult to see out of here. They will add the second can of fuel in the car. Remember, they go all the way here. Davey Allison's car getting ready to come down off the jacks. Groovy Marlin's car coming down out of turn four, and maybe Davey Allison will get back on the speedway. Davey headed back, and Marlin comes by the stripe.
Oh, that they really didn't need to wait on the gas. They lost a couple seconds there. They didn't need a full tank of gas to get to the finish with the mileage they're getting and the distance to the finish. They would have saved themselves a couple seconds just going when the tires were done.
Well, of course, Sterling Marlin has taken over the lead, but his crew chief, Jake Elder, is about standing by ready for him to come into the pits. Of course, Davey Allison did go a lap down, but Sterling Marlin will be coming in here very shortly, and that'll probably put Lake Speed back in the lead.
But not this time. Sterling Marlin stays out on the racetrack with 318 laps completed now. And the Piedmont Airlines Oldsmobile is still out there, but the crew is readying itself for Sterling to drop down off the banking and come in. And it could come this time. We'll see. He's in turns three and four, and yes, he makes the turn to the left and heads for pit road. So here comes Sterling Marlin, who was the leader, and now all of those who were up front have come in for a stop. Jerry Punch once again will be calling this pit stop, and Sterling's pit just a couple ahead of the Davey Allison pit. Jerry?
Jake Elder brings the car to a stop rather abruptly as Sterling gets the car halted. They work on the right side of the car and they're changing right side rubber. Lake Speed in the right upper part of your screen. Lake Speed trying to come around. Sterling Marlin trying to get his crew. Good pit stop. Marlin down the way, and we'll watch Lake Speed coming down and see who will win the race back to the track.
Well, Lake Speed has already gone by, Jerry. However, Sterling Marlin was running quite a bit behind him, but Sterling Marlin has made the best pit stop according to our watches up here. That pit stop was a little less than 14 seconds, and as Gary pointed out a little bit earlier, they don't have to take on a fuel tank of fuel right now because they don't have that many laps left, and they can change tires faster than they can put in the fuel.
Yeah, as a crew chief, I always used to tell my gas man, okay, we're not going to wait on you this time. You better be quick.
Jeff Bodine, who temporarily went into the lead, comes in for a pit stop now, and this will be his final of the afternoon. There's the crew going to work on the right side of that car.
Now, you guys definitely don't have to wait on the gas. As soon as that jack drops, you need to go.
Front tire man's already finished, but they're waiting on the gas.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, they were in for about 15 to 9-10 seconds, so they perhaps could have gotten away a couple of seconds earlier, but decided to not do that.
And those couple of seconds are very important when you come down to the closing stages of the race. So, after our pit stops, we still have Lake Speed in the lead as Rusty Wallace stands by for relief driving. Speed World presentation of the Trans-South 500 from Darlington International Raceway. Tonight at 7:30 Eastern Time from Memorial Auditorium in Buffalo, New York, the Detroit Red Wings and the Buffalo Sabres. Now, of course, Detroit has a top spot in the Campbell Conference sewed up. The Sabres have a firm grip on the number three spot in the Adams Division. It should be good at 7:30 tonight, live here on ESPN as the NHL season winds down. All right, Lake Speed leads with Alan Kulwicki second, Sterling Marlin third, Davey Allison fourth, and Bill Elliott fifth. The guys running first, second, and third have never won a Winston Cup race, and Davey Allison, a rookie last year, is also in a very good spot to win here at Darlington. This is an excellent story that we've unveiled here this afternoon.
That is incredible, Bob. Can you imagine how tough this track is for those inexperienced, well, not really inexperienced, but non-winning drivers to be in contention to win?
Well, Sterling, Terry Labonte, the first time he came here, he finished fourth in this race. He had never seen the place before and came and finished fourth, and then his first Super Speedway victory came on this racetrack. So, you know, it's hard to believe that they could do it with a little experience or win their first race here, but it has happened in the past.
Here's a battle for third. Sterling Marlin, number 44, and Davey Allison in number 28, as Allison now is beginning to move the Ford in on the rear bumper of the Oldsmobile driven by Sterling Marlin.
Yeah, it's really time for all of them that can do it to start making their moves. And Bill Elliott sitting in the worst spot at this time. He's over a half a lap down, farther back than he's been all day. It's time to get moving for all of them.
Now, there are only five cars in the lead lap. You mentioned those, of course, Lake Speed leading. Alan Kulwicki second, Sterling Marlin third, Davey Allison fourth, and Bill Elliott fifth. One lap down to sixth place is Jeff Bodine, Bill Parsons is seventh, and Mark Martin eighth. Those three cars all one lap down. Two laps down in ninth is Buddy Baker, and in tenth place is Bobby Allison, also two laps down.
This is where the crew chief really becomes the cheerleader. He's done it all now. The last pit stop's done. All the adjustments are done. He's got to talk to his driver on the radio every chance he can. Tell him that, give him the encouragement he needs to just, if he's Lake Speed, to stay out of trouble. If it's, Alan Kulwicki, his crew chief needs to be telling him, the interval, yeah, you made up a little ground, good lap. Don't tell him about the bad laps. And Sterling Marlin's crew chief and Davey Allison's also.
How much conversation is it, though? Is it something that you do every lap, every half lap, or is it a constant thing?
I've always thought that it was best to talk to your driver every lap if you can only just give him his time from the previous lap. That lets him know that you are part of his team, that he's not out there alone, that you're in the behind the scenes and you're paying attention. You're not on coffee break. You are concerned about how he's doing it. So other crew chiefs have a different way of doing, of looking at that, but I would give them a lap time or good lap so much, you know, you're 3 seconds behind the leader, next lap you're 3.4 behind the leader. Just give them any kind of encouragement you can.
One of those who has had a tough day, Rick Wilson, and Jerry Punch is with him.
Well, Rick is the latest retiree from here at Darlington, and Rick, it's been a rough afternoon for you.
It sure has. You know, it started right first of the race. It looked like Kenny Strader got sideways. We got in a crash there. We come into the pits and worked on the car and got it where I could go back out and drive it. You know, we're just making laps, and it's been running hot. We had a radiator here and there. It wouldn't really fit good. It wouldn't cool good. So finally got to skip it a little bit, so we come back from the car.
Rick, we said at the beginning of the show that maybe a young driver would get his first win. You're looking for your first win. You were close at Rockingham. He had to be pretty happy for Lake Speed. Looks like he may get his first one here.
Yeah, Lake's working real good, you know. Allen's was only pretty tight a while ago, but Lake's working real good. The Oldsmobile's working good, and the Hoosier tires are working good.
Well, Rick Wilson out of it now cheering for his buddy Lake Speed.
Speed continues to set the pace. This, the best battle on the racetrack between Sterling Marlin and Davey Allison for third. Remember, Alan Kulwicki is running in second.
Bob, we took you down through 10th position a little while ago. The scoring has given us a few more positions. Dale Earnhardt is running in the 11th position. Eddie Beerswall is running 12th. Kenny Richard is 13th. Dale Jarrett currently running in the 14th position.
And the leader is in traffic. There is a Lake Speed going underneath Phil Parsons, and right behind Lake Speed is the number six car of Mark Martin that led this race for a while. And Dick Bergeron has some comments on the leader.
I'll tell you, Gary, you were talking a minute ago about conversations between crew chief and driver. Just a lap or two ago, I'm in Lake Speed's pit, and this whole place just broke up. It was as if it was the comedy hour or something. Here's what happened. Darrell Brand had been feeding Lake Speed lap times. All of a sudden, he said, hey, do you want intervals? Do you want to know how far behind they are? And Lake said, forget it. I don't want to know any of that sort of stuff. The whole place went nuts. It really did.
Well, that is interesting. That means Darrell Bryant gives the same kind of information that I was talking about to his driver. Intervals are important, but if the driver doesn't want it, just keep talking to him. Encouragement is the main thing that the driver needs right now.
But sometimes, evidently, Blake doesn't want to know how far that guy is behind him. I remember the first race that I ever won in my life was at Hickory, North Carolina on the dirt track. I had run well. I'd run second many, many times, but I could never get that checkered flag. And I'd get past near the end of the race. We tore our car up, built a new one, took it back up there. They didn't put a rear-view mirror on that thing, and I won the race because I couldn't see the guys behind me.
You don't need rear-view mirrors. All you need to do is look in front of you. 334 laps out of 367 as we continue our coverage of the Trans-South 500. Lake Speed is in command of the Trans-South 500, leading Alan Kulwicki, Sterling Marlin, Davey Allison, and Bill Elliott. Now, we're going to get an interval here next time around when Lake Speed crosses the start-finish line. We'll get the interval clock going. He's going down the backstretch right now and into turn number three, and we'll see how much of an interval there is between first and second, and we'll do that for a couple of laps to see if the interval is shrinking or gaining. Now, Dale Earnhardt, once again, down low on the racetrack to allow the faster cars to pass. Earnhardt has not had a good day. He is three laps down to the leaders. Here comes Alan Kulwicki out of the corner, passing the stripe, and it's a 10.5-second lead for Lake Speed. And once again, Nick will do it this time around also to see if the interval is shrinking or increasing.
Bob, a good deal of that lead came on the pit stopping change. Lake Speed got out of the pits a little faster and didn't stay in quite as long as Alan Kulwicki did, and that has made part of that difference.
It was 10.5 seconds last time. Here comes Alan out of the fourth corner once again. The second car. There it is. It's just about the same. Hardly enough to really mention.
Certainly a tenth of a second a lap is not enough. There's not enough laps remaining if he can only gain that much per lap from now to the end of the race.
Yeah.
Jerry Punch is in the Brett Bodine pits, and we've talked about the last several laps about how Brett is not feeling well at all. Jerry, what's the update?
Well, it may only be 25 laps to go for us, but it's an eternity for Brett Bodine. I'm with Greg Moore, the son of Bud Moore, and the engine builder for the car. And Greg, what has Brett said to you on the radio?
Well, Jerry, essentially what's happened since that earlier wreck, when Bob was right earlier today, the front suspension and stuff has been on the car to where the car's real hard to steer. And the situation is his arms was getting tired. We thought he was going to need relief. We had Rusty Wallace standing by, but now we think he's going to be okay.
Well, Brett Bodine's arms are just about giving out. He's going to try to hang on these final 22 or 23 laps. We'll keep an eye and see if he can hang on. Let's go to Larry Newber in pit central. Larry?
Well, Jerry, there is great consistency among the top five cars and drivers in terms of the amount of time and work that's been completed in the pit area. Each of them has stopped either six or seven times. Interestingly enough, our race leader, Lake Speed, has only stopped six times. Each of the five cars has also changed either 18 or 20 tires, so a great deal of parity there. Remember that Hoosier tires are on the leading car of Lake Speed and the number 44 car of Sterling Marlin. So the top five cars have had a relatively smooth day considering how much complexities and how many tragedies are out there waiting and lying in wait for you at Darlington. And here's Dick Bergman with more from his vantage point on pit road.
Well, Larry, as the laps wind down, there is little that can be done here on pit road. The crews of the two cars in first and second are wandering back and forth, checking tires, rechecking them again. Hence the caution happens. Lake Speed's guys are hoping and praying none does. Kulwicki's guys are hoping and praying that one does. So we've got a very different strategy here, but everybody is just calm, waiting, and crossing fingers. It is winding down, getting near the end.
Boy, the one that really needs a caution right now is Bill Elliott. He's 1.5 seconds from being lapped. If he gets out of the lead lap, he he's going to have a hard time from here out. Bill Elliott's been taking it easy in our eyes, but it looks like he may be a little bit off right now. You can see the difference there, one car between them.
Elliott moves into turn number one, and that is Brent Bodine, I believe. And the leader there is the third car on the right side of your screen, Lake Speed.
You know, one time, it's funny when you talk about drivers needing relief, because anytime a driver would say that to me, and then I'd end up getting one of the name or a good driver in the pit area, they'd always seem to get a little more surge to make it to the finish. They'd start saying, oh, I'm a little tired, you better get somebody standing by. And you come up with somebody and you say, okay, I got so-and-so here in the pits ready for you. Well, I think I can make it. It always happens. I've never, in some cases, they just have to get out, but usually it happens that way.
Here's a battle for third once again as Sterling Marlin in 44 and Davey Allison in 28 continue to contest that position. That is the number 88 car of Buddy Baker, also in this trio. But the Pastor cars go to the outside and pass. There's the leader, Lake Speed. And he could become a Winston Cup millionaire today. He only needs $12,000 to move above that mark. The top five, Lake Speed, Alan Kulwicki, Sterling Marlin, Davey Allison, and Bill Elliott. Our live coverage of the Trans-South 500 brought to you by Dodge Cars and Trucks. When it's got to be right, it's got to be a Dodge. By Quaker State Motor Oil, the big Q stands for quality, always has, always will. By Murray, Murray mowers are tough as they come. And by Kodak Color Watch System for great film development. Leader is Lake Speed, and he is within just a few laps of his first Winston Cup victory ever, and it's coming at a racetrack that is as tough as they come.
Boy, he's looking good. 14 laps to go, 15 laps to go. He's got a good lead, put Bill Elliott a lap down during that break. He's got a smooth sailing if everything goes good.
His car has worked well all day. You can see on the left side of it, he's been a little close to a few people out there, but no major damage to it. Certainly not anything that's hindered the handling qualities of the car or the running qualities.
Well, I can remember here in 1978, I was working with Darrell Waltrip, and we had a two-lap lead near the end of the race. We'd already made our last pit stop, and Darrell had an accident all by himself. He said he just lost his concentration. That's what happens at this track. It'll make you feel comfortable, and then all of a sudden it'll get you. All the drivers talk about it.
Certainly anything can happen here. We're only 15 laps from the finish, but Lake Speed has not taken the checkered flag by any means yet. This is his 164th career start for Lake Speed, and it could be win number one. And this battle here for third place continues, but Davey Allison has not been able to pass Sterling Marlin. Now, although Dale Earnhardt is three laps down to the leaders, make that four laps down to the leaders, and in 11th position, if the race were to end now, he would still go to the Winston Cup points lead. Davey Allison again trying to make a bid but cannot. Earnhardt would be in the points lead for the first time this season because Neil Bonnett is 26 laps down and out of the top 20.
Bob, we were clocking the distance between Lake Speed and Alan Kulwicki, who's running second a little while ago. It was about 10 and a half seconds then. It's over 14 seconds now, so Lake Speed continues to move away, even though he's running very cautiously at this moment, but the car feels comfortable to him, so he's running her just the way that it feels good to him.
You can see where Davey Allison has lost his sun visor.
Yeah.
The tape they put on is blowing up. I'm sure he's let Robert Yates and the rest of the crew know. Boy, yeah, that might have been a product of that visibility there.
Well, he got way up high and may have put a Darlington stripe on the car down there. Sterling Marlin here in car number 44 in third position, by the way, would move to second in the Winston Cup points, 18 behind Dale Earnhardt for the race to end right now.
That is a tough race there for position, right? Third and fourth spot. Davey's doing all he can.
Boy, he is. Look at this. Down to the inside once again to the start-finish line. He may have him. They're going to go two abreast through there. No, Davey backs off.
His car is not sticking that well down the inside. Big touch. Whew. Momentarily, but Sterling gets it straightened out. Davey backed out of it once he realized that he had touched him. He backed out and laid him straighten out.
It's got to be tough to see that where exactly that car is with the windshields as bad as there.
Well, only nine more laps to go. Will Lake Speed from Jackson, Mississippi win his first Winston Cup race ever? We'll answer that question in a moment. coming down this time will complete lap number 361. There will be six laps to go in the Trans-South 500, and Lake Speed is in command of this race. Here's Larry Neuber at Pit Central.
Well, Bob, remember at the top of the show that we talked about in the last 28 years here at Darlington, only twice has the winner come from outside of the top 10. Well, Lake Speed, where did he start? He started 8th. Alan Kowicki, where did he start this race? He started 3rd. How about Sterling Marlin? Well, he started 16th. Davey Allison would qualify historically. He started 9th in this race. And going back to that RJR poll, as we continue to follow this battle for third spot, there goes Sterling Marlin putting a lap on Dale Earnhardt, being chased by Davey Allison. Back to the RJR poll of all the news media and the people in the crews down here. Who among all the drivers who have not yet won a Winston Cup race did we all expect to be first? Remember, we told you that the overwhelming favorite was Kenny Schrader by a 2-1 margin, but virtually tied for second place in that poll. Who would be the next non-winner to win? Alan Kowicki and Lake Speed. Yeah. For Kenny Schrader, we hit it pretty close, but he was on the pole.
Boy, some tight racing back there in the backstretch. Again, almost some serious contact between Marlin and Davey Allison.
For the last 50 miles or so, this has absolutely been the best race on the racetrack. We have seen them touch several times, and as they get down for the real run for the money, it'll be interesting to see what happens.
Well, you can see Marlin with the white glove on, how he's working the steering wheel. Even on the straightaway, you think they're going straight, but they're working all the way around this track.
You know, guys, I can not get my mind off of Lake Speed's emotion at Daytona when he finished second there a couple of years ago. I can imagine what the emotion is going to be like in victory lane today if he continues to win this race.
Oh, definitely. Looks strong.
Lake is a very devout Christian, and I'm sure that he's going to, first of all, praise the Lord for the good run here today, but it will be interesting to see the emotion that will be involved.
But you guys think it's too late to take a poll on who you think's going to win?
Yeah, I guess we waited a little long, didn't we? If we are, I'll take Lake Speed.
Yeah, I'm in that one, too.
Two more laps to go. There's Lake crossing the stripe. 365 laps completed. 2.6 miles to go for Lake Speed. Look at the nail biting going on.
Nobody's sitting down, that's for sure. They're listening to their headsets to see if the driver says anything.
Oh, and look at this.
Davey Allison has just moved around Sterling Marlin. Sterling slowed down.
Marlin's in trouble, dropping low on the racetrack. Tough break for Sterling. Boy, he had run a solid race all day. Running third, drops to the inside of the racetrack. I don't know whether the car has power or not, but he's going very slowly. Here's the white flag for Lake Speed. Let's follow him around on his final lap of this racetrack and what could be his first win in Winston Cup competition. This is his 164th career start. His best career finish to date has been a second on two different occasions at Daytona and earlier this year at Rockingham. Obviously, this crew is putting things together. They're cheering for him as he heads down the backstretch, now with less than a half lap to go. The Wins Kmart Oldsmobile is about to go into Darlington's victory lane. Here's the checkered flag. Lake Speed wins the Trans-South 500.
Congratulations, Lake.
What a victory. He ran a beautiful race.
He sure did. Here's Alan Kowicki in the Xerex Ford, whom we have been riding with throughout the afternoon, about to finish second. He brings the car down off of corner number 4. Alan Kowicki finishes in second position. Davey Allison is going to wind up in third because of the problem that Sterling Marlin experienced just a lap or so ago. Let's go to Nick Bergeron quickly in the pits.
Well, Darrell Bryan, congratulations. What a wonderful day.
Yeah, it has been. You know, it's been a long time since I won. In fact, it was at this racetrack in 1980, the last race we won, so I'm pretty ticked.
You must have really been on pins and needles for the last few laps, were you not?
No, not really. Not up to about the fifth lap, because like once old Lance McBarney said, it's not over till it's over.
Not bad for a young team.
Thank you, sir.
That's Darrell Bryan. He's the crew chief. These guys are all headed for victory lane in a hurry.
And listen to the crowd. Lake Speed is waving to the crowd, and they are going crazy, welcoming a first-time winner into victory lane at the track too tough to tame, Darlington International Raceway. Back to victory lane in a moment. Speed relaxes in victory lane after winning the Trans-South 500 here at Darlington International Raceway. Let's go to victory lane and Dr. Jerry Punch.
Lake Speed getting a cool drink, and Lake, can you believe it, partner? Congratulations.
I can believe it, but I'm sure glad it finally happened. I tell you what, it seemed like we were going to wait forever before this happened. And, you know, I'm just tickled to death for for the crew and everybody that worked so hard and everything. And, you know, I just have to give the Lord the credit. I mean, 2 years ago, everybody thought I was gone. Look at me now, and that's all because of the Lord Jesus Christ.
We'll let Lake climb out of the car and get a breath of fresh air there as his public awaits. Take a listen here as they are excited about Lake Speed winning it here. And I tell you what, Lake, you got to feel awfully good. Daryl Bryan and the crew did so much. I was talking to your wife, Risa, there. She said, you know, normally they call out lap times, those final few laps, but if anybody was eavesdropping on your radio, they heard a little prayer going across between you and Daryl.
I guarantee you, you know, I can't say there's not anything to say. I've thought about this all my life, you know, what are you going to do when you finally won? And now I'm here. All I can do is say thank you, thank you, thank you, because there's been a lot of people involved to make this happen. It wasn't a thing by myself at all. And the most important thing, I think, is everybody has to realize that in my case, it was my faith in the Lord that brought me through this, because if it hadn't been for that, 1986, I'd have packed it up and head back to Mississippi.
That says it all. 40-year-old Lake Speed and his 164th start makes it to victory lane. Again, congratulations to Lake Speed.
Lake Speed wins his first Winston Cup race, and our winner circle interview has been brought to you by Goodyear Eagle Tires. Goodyear, because there really is a difference. And we'll be back for some closing comments here at Darlington International Raceway on this very long but exciting afternoon of racing that Lake Speed won.